We actually have a quorum, and I like to start on time, because we have a pretty full agenda. So, I want to say, welcome to visitors, welcome to citizens who find the time to come. We really appreciate that interest and ideas that can come forward. We usually follow, in terms of citizen comments or questions, if we stay a small enough group, you just can raise your hand, but otherwise, we'll try and do an official 3 minutes after agenda items, if we get to be a bigger group, deal with that. I'm just going to give a quick overview, and some of you have heard this 10 times, but I just want to do it one more time, just to clarify.
You think you'll finally get it right, Pat?
I might get it right this time, so let me go ahead. They, in theory, they already know this committee, but let me just say, the Justice System Task Force of the Yellow Springs Village Council is not a police review. We're not taking complaints about the police. And we weren't set up to respond to the mayor's event. That's not, in fact, we were conceived, thought of last summer. And we had our first actual working meeting, I guess that was October, that we actually got busy with some things. And our charge, and actually have it here with me, and I'm willing to pass it around if anybody wants to take a closer look. But basically, it happened because there were other incidents. There have been other incidents in the village that concern citizens. And we're also aware that at the national level and at the state level, there's a lot of discussion about things not being quite right with how policing is taking place in communities. Just to be more specific about Ohio, Governor Kasich created a commission following up on some of the police murders of unarmed young black men, including here in Green County, up the road. So there was, at the level, the state level, there was concern with what's going on here and what should we do about it. And then some of that stuff ended up in the Attorney General's office in the form of unfunded mandates and requirements for training. And so the idea of the task force was, let's look at what's going on in the state, nationally, and in our local community, and then try to look at the whole system, not just the police department, but the mayor's court, Green County Municipal Court, prosecutors, sort of how does the system work, and where are the gaps between what we think we want and what's happening. And we had a two-year timeline. Well, that sort of blew up on New Year's Eve. People had much more concern after that about could we come up with reform issues that, again, looked at the gap between what the community says it wants and what's happening here. And then, as you know, since then we've had, sometimes I feel like every person in Yellow Springs wakes up in the morning thinking about the police department. I don't think it's true, but there's been so many good ideas, groups, projects, programs, and one of our goals tonight is to spend a short amount of time making sure that the whole the Justice Task Force, as well as people who are here as visitors, that you know everything that's happening, because there's so much that's going on. So that's what's moving. But let me just pause and ask if anyone has questions about how and what the Justice System Task Force is doing, will do. Well, everybody understands? Great. Okay. We'll go forward with our meeting, and because we are an official group, we're following open meeting sort of rules, and again, we'll try and stop at different times to see if anybody in the room would like to ask a question or wants to add some other kind of information. Well, we do have some official visitors. Probably most people know who they are, but let's go ahead and ask council members to just stand briefly and introduce themselves.
Brian Ash.
Jerry Sim.
Okay, welcome. And our village manager, Patty Bates, is here. And our interim police chief.
Brian Carlson.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
And Judy, huh?
Oh, yeah, Judy. Judy is our council liaison, which is part of our process. We asked, again, because we're official and we have to follow open meeting rules, and we're now at the place where we're generating a lot of paper, and we're not sure about what we do with that paper and how we talk to each other. We asked Judy for the second time, because she is, if you didn't know, she is our village guru on open meetings. So she's going to give us a few more hints about how we're operating. Take it away, Judy.
Okay, well, you know, you've kind of heard this spiel, I think, previously. I have information, I'll pass it around. Who caught the spiel the first time when I came? And who's gone online and done the fabulous Sunshine Law training? Yeah! Okay, so that, it's extremely helpful until you actually encounter a situation and then you go, oh, I didn't cover that at all. So you have to sort of extrapolate and figure out at that point what needs to be done. The way that I described it initially was like this. If you're on one of council's boards or commissions, you have now been invited to the party. That party, by definition, doesn't include other folks who were not selected for that particular board or commission. There may be folks who are very interested, can't make it at that time, wanted to be selected and were not. There are a million reasons why there are folks who couldn't come to that party, and they need to be able to know what it is that you're doing, what you're talking about, everything that's going on at the party, because they want to be able to see it, to participate in as much of a way as they're able to do, even if it just means gathering information. And kind of the way I described it was that that's obvious when you're having a meeting. Of course, everyone is invited. They listen to you do your business. They understand what's happening. It gets less clear when things happen like working groups. Okay, well, now there's not a quorum. We have a working group, and we're not going to put in the paper that we're meeting. You aren't going to know when we're meeting, and we don't necessarily need to invite people to our meeting. That's kind of as if at that party, three of you walked into the kitchen and had a private conversation, and everyone standing outside that fence said, hold it, what is going on in the kitchen, because I can't even see in there. So the point is they need to know what you did in the kitchen. The notes from the working group or the drafts of what it is that you're working on or whatever it is that you do in that kitchen needs to come back out into the public setting and be made public. So you present it at your open meeting. You say, here's what our working group discussed and decided. If folks say, you know, I'd like to come to that, really there's no reason that they shouldn't be able to do that. I think just good courtesy is to announce at your meeting, here's when those working groups will meet. You're not legally required to notice that in the paper because it's not an official meeting of the whole commission, but it's good practice to do it that way. Emails, Facebook, whole new reality where it becomes a meeting. If I email you and four other members of the group, and then you all start responding, yeah, I think that's a great idea. No, I don't agree with her at all. Now we're having a meeting. So that is also not permissible. And usually, I'm sure I've seen Pat say, I'm sending you this information, don't respond. Or only respond to me, because otherwise we're illegally having a meeting. Some folks here at the table have had the unfortunate experience of just posting something on Facebook that suddenly became a thread, and now, whoops, you're all having a meeting. So you didn't intend it, it wasn't what you meant, but you're having a meeting all of a sudden. So there are a lot of ways that you can kind of get sucked under the bus when you just didn't mean to do that at all. So that's sort of a very basic, the whole idea of it is, it's out in the light, so it's called Sunshine Law. Everyone's got access to it, everyone knows what you're doing. Or if they don't, can say, could I see a copy of that document you guys said you were working on? And if it's a draft that you're going to share with the whole group, yes, they can.
Judy, can you speak to serial communications?
Other than what I just did, then what do you mean?
I mean, just how you know, kind of from one person to another?
Well, I'll give an example with council. Let's say that members of council don't really want to be embarrassed at the table if there's no one that wants to vote for a particular ordinance. I mean, it would be embarrassing, right? You bring it up, and there you'd sit, and everyone would go, absolutely not, that's a horrible idea, my goodness. There you are publicly having a moment where one person says, geez, I thought it was awesome. And everyone else goes, that was the worst idea ever. Channel 5 records it, everyone's a little embarrassed. So, oh, how much easier if, let's say, Judith has this great idea, and she maybe calls Karen and says, I am thinking of bringing this. What do you think? What sounds good to me. Yeah, okay. Or, hey, Brian, what do you think about my idea? That sounds fine to me. Can't do it. Can't do it. You're having a meeting. And, in fact, you can't have someone else do it for you. Everything that takes place in that manner where people say, whoa, that's a terrible idea, has to be done in public so that everyone can see you have that conversation and understand why it is that you did or didn't do whatever it is you did or didn't do.
Well, councils, we have a meeting when there's five of us, so the majority is three. Two people can get together and bring a proposal together. It's just that third person that can't, you know, you right. can't be talking to the third person trying to make a decision outside.
So the question that is up for me right now is we're starting to generate drafts of recommendations and reports, and we want to share them and we're not quite ready for the most part, sometimes we are, to put them out more in the public, but we haven't, and we'll do this today, we haven't totally clarified how we decide that the whole committee agrees that this should go to the council. So we have all these drafts and we want people to...
Mm-hmm. We can share them, we can send, like a working group could send them to the whole group, we just can't, so people could be prepared, because we don't want to come in.
They just can't respond.
They just can't respond.
So one way communication is successful.
Like the council, yes.
Well, and then the question is does the public need to be able to see that draft if it comes out of the working group?
I would say so. Does HRC publish every draft and put it? No, because they don't always have them ready, and somebody's still running around at 6:50, quickly getting their stuff together, and it's not because there's subterfuge or some attempt to hide it from anyone, just didn't get ready in time. And so then it's brought to the group, and then it becomes, you know, this public document. So, no, it's not a requirement that you put it out ahead of time.
Okay.
No, but, you know, once it's there for the group, and are you required to put it online and make it generally available? No, you're not. You just bring it to your meeting and say, here are the things that we're discussing, and it's on Channel 5, and people in the room can say, could I get a copy of that?
Uh-huh.
And yes, they can.
Okay.
But you don't have to push
it.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Any other questions from the committee?
Yeah, I was reading about the email. Can somebody call me and say, I want to see all your emails?
Somebody can't call you and say that. No. They call me and say that. And then I can vet that request. So if that person says literally, I want all of David Turner's emails, I can say, well, it's overly broad. So I need to know what it is you need. And then it gets narrowed, and then I say to you, you know, David, I need all of the emails that you have that refer to this particular thing. And then, yes, you do.
Even if it's, you know, just Al and me meeting as part of our subgroup, saying, important tomorrow at noon? Yeah,
no.
Maybe.
They spend a lot of time in Sunshine Law training on this one. If it's along the same lines of something you jot on a post-it and stick on something to remind yourself, I have a meeting, or don't forget to bring a gallon of coffee because whatever.
Yeah.
You don't have to keep that. And it isn't relevant to process or product, other than I needed to be there at a certain point. It has to be relevant to process or product to be...
That makes sense.
You are, in fact. And in fact, if you have an email that says, Al, I completely agree with you, we need to revise section B and change it to such and so, and by the way, Kate Hamilton's hair was horrendous. I can take that and say, the comment about Kate Hamilton's hair is not relevant to product, and I can redact it legally. And so there is kind of this perception that, oh my God, I hurt where I said the stupid joke. Yeah. It's not relevant either. So
how can we comment about her hair? I'm really feeling.
Now, what she does to you personally, I can't have no control over that, but yes.
Okay, one other question. We have invited the public through emails and other ways. If you have an interest in one of our four working groups and you want to be a regular part of that process, mm-hmm. and you know, a good example is Ellis's best practice group. Sarah Wallace, who's a great citizen resource, has come to these meetings. So what is her responsibility in relation to any of these things, or none?
None.
She's
not an official member.
All right.
Yeah.
Are there any questions from visitors? Okay. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
You're welcome, Shannon. So consent agenda, just...
I just wondered if we wanted to, I know we've been talking at the different meetings that the council's had, but I kind of know if we wanted to just hear from him, you know, give him a little chance to talk to him, add Chief to the agenda.
Sir?
I wondered if Chief wanted to come onto the agenda just to maybe talk about what he's been thinking about, and I don't know
if you want to, Brian, are you listening? We can wait and
put him. See if you want to say something.
Okay. I actually have the chief's, I'll just call it mission statement, or what he shared at the council meeting, and I was going to share that among the committee, and that might be a time that if you wanted to add anything. Anything else people feel should be checked? Okay, can we approve our notes from our last meeting, which was January 10th, which were, those notes were mailed to you?
So moved.
Second. Mm-hmm. Agreed?
Okay,
the notes are approved. Judith, we're going to give, it's part of the goal of telling people what's going on here.
What's going on? I had notes on my phone, and I can't bring them up.
I don't know what to deal with here, so I apologize. So it's going to be a little newness up here.
That's terrible.
I'm sorry. We just realized that Steve, who's our secretary, is not here because he had a death in his family.
Oh.
So we're not taking notes, which is not a good thing. So,
is
but you have the video.
Yeah, video camera.
Thank you.
And he's transcribed from that for HRC before.
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Okay, never mind.
Sorry, Jude.
No, no problem. Okay, so yeah, I had notes on my phone and I'm not able to bring them up. So I just kind of jotted some things down quick about what is council doing, kind of where things are at. First thinking about the New Year's Eve event and issues related to that. Of course, everybody knows that our interim chief has been hired, Brian Carlson, and he has hired at least one other person who I could see sitting over here. Lee Puccione, Lee is now coming on for his part of time. So, and if chief has anything to add there.
You want to stand over?
Yeah.
Lucy lives in the village. She worked for the department a few years ago, and she resigned and moved to another department. She's badged with the county currently as a special deputy. She's also a realtor, but I think she brings a tremendous amount of knowledge, wealth in policing to the department, and we are very lucky to have her back.
I've been a resident for the past 16 years, and I really enjoyed
regarding the New Year's Eve events, the council hired an independent counsel, independent investigator, who is, putting together, doing an investigation to be able to explain to the community this is what happened. That was supposed to be reported out last night, but it was not complete. At the same time, Patty, our village manager, has started a disciplinary investigation as well, which will be going parallel to this. Council has said next meeting, which is next Tuesday because of the President's Day, because on Monday is a holiday, so our meetings move till Tuesday, that there will be some kind of report coming up from the investigation. And if it's not entirely complete, the final complete one will be, we can expect first meeting in March, which is what it is, the 6th, okay, yeah. So last night at the meeting, you know, there was just, I think, you know, some good sharing again, citizens kind of describing, you know, their thoughts, their experience, and Brian introduced himself there again, and that was great. So I think it was a worthwhile meeting, so we did not get the investigated, the report yet. There's some other groups, you know, we're a governmental group. There's a 365 group, which has been, you know, in town for many years, addressing issues of racism. And there is a group in the 365, a subgroup of 365, which is working on, which has been looking at the vision statement for the police department that was developed by council. I mean, it still says draft on it, so I'm not quite sure whatever, if it actually was adopted. But anyway, they did present some recommendations for, you know, adding to that vision statement, kind of fleshing it out more to council at the last meeting. And so I think it would be great for the committee to be looking at that. I know council's got so much on their plate, they are relying on the task force to help with some of this work. Also, Mr. Laity's class in high school has, it sounds like, I just heard, I haven't been there, but they've invited a lot of really great speakers, you know, the chief, the inner chief, Reverend Randolph, Pat, to talk about policing. This young man, I've forgotten your name, is from that class. Yeah. And they're basically doing projects and, you know, developing their ideas about how, you know, things that we, the council, should be thinking about. So, again, we really want to be hearing from what are, you know, non-governmental groups, basically, and independent citizens who are, you know, being a part of this process as well. And my feeling about it is those groups are very important. The governmental groups are doing, you know, it tends to be a little slower process. And sometimes and we need the fresh ideas of citizens, citizen groups, and also sometimes the pressure if we start getting too sluggish and we're not coming through the way the village feels we should. So it's a very important role that non-governmental organizations and individuals play. A couple of our members of our committee have had to drop their membership because of, you know, conflicts in their personal schedules. So we are again looking at people who had applied previously, and also we've got some new applications. There's two positions that we are now filling. We're part of, Mary Ann and I have been interviewing a handful more people, and we're thinking a lot about sort of the mix in the group and trying to have, so we'll be making recommendations to council, and in the next probably month, we will be filling those two positions. So we bring a recommendation to council, they add the person to the group. So. And I think that's,
how about the mediation initiative?
Oh, sorry, I put Patty here and I forgot, and I didn't get finished writing it and I forgot what it was.
Did those recommendations come through this group too, or just through council and then down?
Say it again.
Did those recommendations go to council and down, or through us? And
we generally, the way we do it with our groups, our commissions and so on, is the council members make that recommendation. If anybody has anybody they want to encourage to apply, we always think that makes good sense.
I was thinking of, I don't know who these people are, I have no specifics in mind of antagonists.
Yeah.
You know, being not put together.
There was an announcement invitation in the newspaper with a deadline, which has passed, and the interviews, which they're...
I mean, the one thing Mary Ann and I felt is that if we could get, we're particularly interested in younger people and people of color to, you know, have more of a, you know, representation on this committee. And given that those groups particularly can have different populations with the police, so that's one, you know, thing that we've been thinking about.
Patty has started an initiative, which, do you want to explain it very briefly, or?
I can, if you'd like, yeah. It's called the Village Mediation Program, it's a really long name. Village Mediation Program, Community Police Relations Initiative. And I've worked with John Gudgel, Linda Radowski, and Catherine Hamilton to create a program where it's going to start out with Catherine and Linda coming in and facilitating some conversations amongst and with the police officers to let them vent a little bit and then give them some feedback on how the community perceives things and sees things. And then after they become a little comfortable with that process, then we will open it up to stakeholders of key groups. Someone from this task force who will be of your choosing, and ask you. Stakeholders from a number of different groups to come in and start one-on-one, you know, start conversations with the officers, have the actual community involvement with the officers, with the key stakeholders, and it's quite an extensive list of stakeholder groups. Then once we get that part of it done, we will open it up to the general public to interact with the officers and sit down and have conversations with them. Perhaps like open A and B up, set up tables where there's one or two officers sitting there, and you can sit down and have a conversation with that officer and start to interact with them, get to know them, and talk about things one-on-one and, you know, in a respectful, positive environment. And maybe make some headway that way. And actually was just looking at my emails, we're trying to set up the days that this is going to happen on and when it's going to start. So that should be starting pretty soon.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Was that everything?
Just about everything. Obviously there's a lot happening, a lot of different groups. I'm going to take this back to the chief. Carlson, and maybe he could just read it because he is also thinking about goals and initiatives. And this is what we presented to council. If you wouldn't mind just reading it again.
No problem. Our active mission for the Village of Yellow Springs Police Department is to consistently earn the trust of the residents and visitors in our community. We accomplish our mission through a team approach, proactive policing, continuing education, and consistent communication with the community. We strive to be recognized as compassionate, respectful, highly trained, and innovative in our decisions as peace officers. It is active, so any suggestions or help would be greatly appreciated.
You gotta be careful about that, because yeah, there's a lot of them right now.
I know. So. It's okay, I'm getting a lot better at everything coming in. I would like to say one thing, since I have the floor for just a second, something that I have overlooked as a new leader here, and something that I would ask everyone if you could consider the thinking and thoughtfulness of all the department, all the officers. It seems that in public there's a select few of us that are mentioned when it is a cohesive team and we have good officers that do their jobs, protect, serve. It's just they're not known because they work the shift when all of us are tucked in. And I'm going to be working on some shift changes and swap shift, if you will, where we can get officers to be recognized and on the street during the day. But just keep that in the back of your mind, because we do have a real good crew and they do a very good job, and unfortunately some events can kind of tarnish everyone.
Thank you. Thanks. So I guess in terms of committee work here. When we last had a sort of more formal discussion via memo with the council, we agreed to have some level of a coordinating role, not realizing, well, we're thrilled, of course, but we have, for example, right now, in addition to the ideas, because there are just so many great ideas, we have the initiatives of the 365 group. HRC has had a long list for some time that they're still bringing forward. We have 6 proposals out of the high school class right now to consider. So we haven't really totally sorted out what coordination means. What is it? That we would have some way that we are aware of these things. I wouldn't say vet them, but at least look at them and to see where they overlap or how they're identical to other things that are going on or that we're proposing. And then in some way, move it through the council. I mean, we don't have any clear direction from the council about how that will happen, but we do know that we have things coming in. So that's all that I really have to say about it right now.
I just wonder if there's specific recommendations or suggestions that, you know, with the working groups, if we could try to identify what working group do they should that be sent to. And I don't know if that's a role you can play in terms of, so that, you know, we can be responding to those ideas.
Okay. Probably better than any place else.
Well, this will evolve as we go along, but basically we're sort of a repository of a lot of things right now, and I don't feel we don't have any particular authority other than some coordinating about it, so just to keep people up to date about that. We also, at that same meeting and within that same memo, offered to work with Manager Bates about the whole thinking about how we would go forward with the search for the permanent chief. And that's, of course, a 6-month process. I mean, that's a lengthy process. But we have had at least 2 meetings to at least start thinking about how we'll think about it, that. And We have had a volunteer from the 365 group. If you want to just stand up and say hi to yourself.
Hi. I'm on the subcommittee of the leasing policy, or
leasing.
I always forget the official name.
Right.
The one working on police stuff.
They're working on police stuff, yeah, yes. Right, out of the 365 group. So, you know, that kind of thing, hiring someone is pretty, you know, the position description, the recruitment operations, the interviewing, the community involvement. So it's just getting started. But we do know that the community wants to have input on this, and we're trying to think that through, and there'll be a time, not in the not too distant future, where that's clear how that happens. Let me just stop there and see if there's questions from anyone. Okay. Then the third thing in terms of that conversation was, because of the New Year's Eve event, there was a little bit of a feeling of, well, it'd be great if this committee didn't take 2 years to come up with ideas, you know, maybe we should try to have some, maybe an interim report. So I have for us a proposal. It has a draft on it, if you want to grab it. What this is a way of organizing a format, so to speak. And basically it's taking the 6 pillars out of the President's Task Force on 21st Century Policing Implementation Guide. So now this was a...
I can't find something like that.
Yeah, here.
That should have two pages to it. This one is front and back, and then this one behind.
There's some more down here.
Yeah, this doesn't need to be attached to anything.
But does it start with number four?
Yeah.
That's the second page. Or the third, actually.
One, two, three, six.
Oh, there's.
Okay.
It has a, it's the third page.
You have two copies, if you can get copies. About under that, and it's the section one. Do you have an extra copy?
No.
Maybe you could get closer and share?
Oh, here, I do have it.
You have an extra copy. There should be enough copies for everyone, otherwise one. Okay, so again, this is just an organizing format. Taking those six pillars, this came out of President Obama's initiative to have a task force, a president's task force on policing. Again, responding to national issues and concerns about policing. And the six pillars, as you can see, are trust and legitimacy, policy and oversight, technology and social media, community policing and crime reduction, training and education, and officer wellness and safety. The advantage of using this, other than just, besides just having a way to organize recommendations, is that this is a document that is very well known among professionals in policing and in government. It's widely understood. It's easy to get a hold of, by the way, if anyone wants to Google it, get the whole report. The examples, I've put examples to show how this works, and you can see that some of those examples, and I think I put a little asterisk towards ones that we've already discussed at some point. So we wouldn't necessarily have every single one of these in the report, but we would have, possibly in our first interim report, we might have one under every category or two under every category. So want to just take a minute and look at it, and then we can discuss the pros and cons of doing it that way.
I mean, I think it's a good way for us to organize our recommendations, but I don't foresee, personally, I don't foresee an interim report. I foresee us, and what I was imagining was, you know, as we, you know, prepare reports and they're ready to come forward to council, I mean, I guess I do think of it as a little bit like it'll be a little bit, you know, this piece, that piece, at least initially, and especially issues, recommendations that may have had some relationship to the New Year's Eve event where the community was saying, you know, we need some things to move more quickly. At the same time, you know, I had said at the last council meeting, I do think having our new interim chief in place, I think it has reassured the community in a way that gives us a little more space. We don't want to be rushing in a way that doesn't make sense. But I know, for example, the use of mayor's court, that's something citizens want to see move forward and work quickly. Some movement on that anyway. And so
well, we do have at least four close to ready. Mm-hmm. To go. So in that sense, I personally feel rather than doing this one, that one, and this one, and that one, that if we can do one report that puts forward, I mean, that's what I'm calling an interim report.
Okay. Gotcha.
It might even
you would try to organize it this way.
They would eventually organize in this kind of manner.
Yeah.
With backup materials for people to look at. And that actually is just step one. So let's say, for example, and we'll be talking about it very soon, the mayor's court working group saying, well, we want to go forward and here's what we recommend.
Yeah, that's right.
Wait. That comes first to this committee, because the whole committee has to have consensus. Yeah, we think that's a great idea. Or, wait a minute, you didn't do this part. So it doesn't come right from the working group, it comes to this task force. And then once this task force says, yeah, this is great, let's take it to council. So then it goes to council, which accepts it, rejects it, asks for different things, and then it has to go into some level of implementation, right? Some level of review and implementation, which is a piece that we haven't yet thought through, how we do and don't support that task force, or just hand it over to the council and that's it. Or you know, whose desk does it end up on, and is it then a policy change or a it can be all kinds of things.
Yeah, the kind of thinking is downstream, and each one's going to be different. It's going to be overlapping, so I don't feel like we need to worry too much about that at this stage.
I think we do. But go ahead.
I think it's really important that we show the community and everyone that we are doing something.
Right.
And our mayor's court subgroup has been working very hard. We have, I think, was emailed to everyone on the committee asking them to review it. And
right.
I was hoping we could talk about it tonight.
We are.
And then
we could make
something so the council looks good, that this group is doing something. The community feels that we're just not talking and waiting for lawyers to give reports,
but we're
doing something.
I think we're all in agreement.
We want to do something.
We want to have I'm going to call it an interim report. We want a report that's going to have those recommendations out of working groups that the whole committee feels are ready to go as a recommendation. Everybody agree with that?
No.
What's your problem with it?
Well, I think, I mean, we have a recommendation to send to council now. Now, of course,
but you can't, this is the whole committee, which will look at your recommendation and make a decision that, yeah, it's ready to go.
Well, that's what we would like to do.
We will.
And the way that we figured we'd do it was we'd bring copies to the meeting, and then
right.
we'd all talk about it, and we'd do go through that process. So, I mean, I understand that process. I'm not saying, send it to them, but we're pretty much finished after, with what we need to do until we get feedback.
Right.
So
right.
I suspect
we're in agreement. We're in agreement. And we have another, we can move along. We're going to come right to that.
Okay.
I'm not trying to talk about mayor's court specifically. I'm using it as an example to talk about how to talk about talking about things, which is what you're talking about.
Okay.
I think that assuming that we can fairly quickly with any report, let's pick this as an example, come to some neat conclusion, say, okay, hey, Verily, this is good, we want to give it to council. We should give it to council and not wait another month or whatever it would take to have a meeting, or 2 months to have yet another meeting to then put it together.
We're not deciding that right now. We're not.
I thought that you asked if we wanted to do it your way, and I'm saying I want to do it a different way.
And we hear from some other people, Kate and John.
Well, I feel like you're saying the same thing.
Yeah, I do too.
In a way. I mean, my understanding was that the working groups would come up with a recommendation, it would be agreed upon here, and then at the next council meeting, if it was decided, that it would be presented.
Right.
Correct?
Well, that's correct, except that I'm saying, to me it makes more sense, but I could be defeated, of course, that we put several recommendations in one report instead.
Oh.
Here's one, and then here's one, and then here's one.
But theirs are ready. I mean, for example, I have one that I'm supposed to,
right,
that I am working on, but it's not going to be ready today. And it's not going to be ready by the next council meeting.
If we
can
do one right now and three later, why would all three to be done and send them all at once?
Let's hear from everybody.
I kind of agree.
Why don't we see what we end up with at the end of the meeting? If we have two or three recommendations that we think are, we want to say, go ahead and bring that forward to council. Then we can put it all in one report.
You said that you got six from Mr. Lighty's class?
Sorry?
You said you got six recommendations
six.
From Mr. Lighty's class?
Yes, six.
Well, maybe we could look at all of them first, and if, like she said, at the end of the meeting, we decide that only that one is ready to be presented, then we only present that one.
Well, I got those last night, and these working groups have put this forward some time ago, so unless we're willing to stay really late, I don't think we'll be able to get to those.
Right.
I don't think everyone in the committee has seen them yet. They were just handed out last night. So that was
so only this one is ready, right?
No. We have two.
So that can come to the next meeting.
It
we'll
can
be
come
prepared
to the next
to
meeting.
Look at the
and we might consider that we need to have a meeting before
What would council prefer? Do you prefer smaller?
I don't think it matters.
Amounts or just huge amounts of recommendations?
You know, I like the idea of using something, these six pillars, which is seems like it's a, if it's something that's been being used, it seems like it could be useful in terms of putting them under those particular pillars, whatever they are. But I think as things are ready, they could come to the council. If there's two or things ready, it can be in an interim report. But you're imagining several interim reports.
We're a group looking at a system. We're not looking at this. So I think if you look at the whole system and think of it in the way that was thought of under the president's commission to look at a system and change it, that is a better way to do it. But if people feel like they need to do pop-up recommendations, then that's what we're doing.
I like the six pillars, but we might need a seventh pillar because I don't know that these are applicable to the mayor's court.
Okay.
And no, since that's part of our mandate, these are police reform pillars. And I don't have the title for your seventh pillar tonight, but probably there is.
Right. That's a good point.
I hear what you're saying about how certain recommendations looked at individually might feel piecemeal and that we wouldn't want to send them to the village council by themselves because other things directly connected to adjacent issues ought to also be considered and then as a whole those recommendations brought to council. But I guess I'm also sort of agreeing with David that that basically your point is right, but then as we're considering a recommendation, we can just take that into consideration. And then with that recommendation, basically be like, yeah, we like it. We're putting it to the side until this basket is full. Or, yeah, we like it. And it feels like a full basket unto itself.
I hear you saying you don't have a strong feeling.
Oh, okay.
I know what you're saying.
Oh, just that we don't, rather than ahead of time being like, these are the baskets. Right. You find out what the baskets are as the recommendations come.
Okay.
But,
and the other piece in terms of reporting is this.
So this is the fill line.
Right. The other piece in terms of reporting is what I mentioned earlier, which is we have things coming in. As Nia just mentioned, the six papers from the high school students. The chief himself is coming forward with some thoughts about changes within the department. Some of those overlap with things that we're talking about. So sort of getting some way that they all come together instead of, here's this from 365, here's this from the chief's office, here's this from the... So there's some way that, in terms of reporting, that goes out to the entire community.
Yeah, sorting and outlining would be useful.
Outlining this, I think, is somewhat useful. Yeah.
Is there a possibility that some of the things that we're about to get from those different groups are going to overlap with whatever
that is what I'm saying.
Yeah, and then that will have to be added, and if there are good points and everything, right? I mean, to the recommendation that's given to council.
Well, something I think is very important to keep in mind that most institutions don't, particularly private ones, is that when you put some policy or procedure in place, that's not the end of it. It would be appropriate to revisit after 3 months, 6 months, whatever, periodically, whatever is appropriate for that particular thing, to see how it's working and then make changes. So I would hope that these things would be set in stone, and part of the effort of council and the police department would be to look at it, you know, long after we've been disbanded. Which would take care of that kind of a thing. In the interim, we should do the same thing. It's over the long term also.
I kind of feel like we should just go forward with these reports because I think what you're bringing up is important, and it can feel kind of disorganized. A lot of things are coming in from different directions. And then, you know, Chief, who's running the department now, he's trying to make the changes, and, we don't want to get in his way. I think the organizational piece, as a disorganized person, the organizational piece, it's not a way I think about it. I can see the point to it because it could get a little chaotic, this whole process. So I think, why don't we hear the reports? Because I think if we have some concrete proposals, then we'll see the purpose of this over time, organizing it through these pillars over time. And if someone can come up with the seventh pillar, if we want to use those as how we organize it to council, and that's one of our first proposals, is about the mayor's court, and it's not one of the pillars, then we should just come up with a name for it, and I don't think it has to be complicated. It could be the mayor's court, I don't know, or something then, like that.
John?
And then I did want to offer one criticism of the pillars, which is that I feel like aligning the police department's investigative and enforcement priorities, what sort of like criminal activity they feel like is important to gather information about, and what sort of criminal activity they feel like is important to write tickets for, that aligning that with what the community wants is really important, and I can't quite tell whether that goes under pillar two or pillar four. So I just wanted to throw that out there.
Well, maybe three, because it has to do with records people. Data, maybe. Release of data. Anyway, something to think about.
Okay, so we'd actually like if we could hear very briefly from all of our working groups and also let people know what those working groups are. And so should we start with it or end with the mayor's work? How about if we start with best practices, because I know you have something specific and concrete and one thing, so.
It's one thing. Relatively simple. So the best practices group is looking at best practices policies in a whole variety of areas. And we were asked to focus on the taser use policy. And I'm going to call you Chief Brian. Are people calling you Chief Brian?
That's fine.
And Officer Meiser came to a meeting 2 weeks ago for the best practices subcommittee. It was a really good conversation. We talked about a whole variety of things. I don't know that we actually talked about taser use at that meeting. I don't think we did. But in the course of the meeting, we raised the idea that we'd been asked to take a look at taser use policy. There was certainly a willingness to have us take a look at it. And so we proceeded to do research and draft policy, which the overall group looked at last week and approved. Since then, the chief has gotten back to me with three what I think are very good ideas for how to change the draft that we have. So what I would propose to do is I'm going to hand out two things here. First, you get the old policy, the existing policy.
This was in use, of course.
Pardon?
It's within use.
Yeah, I'll explain. Yeah. So this is the existing policy, and I have extras that I'll try to, let's make sure that everybody at the table gets one of these, and then, right here, and then just extra, pass it on. So this is the existing policy. I better keep one for myself.
Existing.
Oh, here you go, there's one more. That's the existing policy. Now this, the taser use policy is part of the overall use of force policy. So the very first page you have here is the cover page for the use of force policy. And the overall use of force policy it's like 20 pages long. It goes on and on and on. It has some overarching considerations. It talks about use of firearms. It talks about reporting, all kinds of stuff in there. But when you get to page 8 of it, so the second page here in the existing thing is the actual beginning of the taser use policy that we presently have. Okay. Now, if I was any good at using computers, you would have a redlined version of this with my changes. And I prepared such a thing. But the formatting got so crazy that it became absolutely impossible to read. Things were like hanging from ceilings and stuff.
That's what you told me you were going to give me, by the way.
You know, I did you a favor by not giving it. It just got nuts. So my apologies. So I sat around in my committee and I realized you couldn't read. So here's what we have. Here are our proposed changes, and I'll walk you through. And I'll highlight the places where we've changed it. And Chief Bryan can chime in and say the things that he wants changed and the reasons for that. And then hopefully we can come up with something that we like. Here's the next one.
So are there a vast number of changes?
No, it's not that many.
Okay.
I'm going to strictly focus on this draft that I sent around, the new stuff, okay, for you. I'm not going to try to jump back and forth between two documents. You can do that on your own if you're so inclined to do that. So at the beginning of the draft, what you see at the beginning, this is just holdover from the prior document, so ignore everything down to D. The way we changed D is D originally had some material related to taser use in it. I just took it out of D and stuck it in E. So everything about tasers is in E
what
now.
What page are we on?
We're on the first page of the draft use policy. The draft.
And where's the D?
Halfway down.
That's right.
Oh.
Okay.
Got it. All
right. So everything that had to do with tasers that was in D has now been removed. It shows up later on in E. So D is just a smaller version of what it previously was. It just prohibits things.
This D and that are the same. What am I
looking at? Now you're looking at the big D. We're starting with the big D. Prohibited, less lethal weapons. Okay, that's the D I'm talking about. All right? So that's the D that's been changed a little bit. All right? So now the real heart of the matter is E. And here are the changes that we made. So the taser use policy has been changed in these ways. Number one is the same, except we added the P after the X26P. Did I get that right?
Correct.
Okay. So that's the taser that they actually use. We added that. In two, we said that previously it just said that you CEWs, which is the fancy name for tasers, would be used in accordance with response resistance policy, which is the overall policy. Here we added, and provisions of this CEW use policy. So we're specifically saying you got to use it in accord with this particular policy. And then the last line of that is also added. The CEW's use is strictly limited to situations where the only alternative would have been the use of lethal force or firearms. Now, I added that because I thought that made clear where this sits in the hierarchy of force. The chief got back to me and said that he can think of some. Well, what, you're here. Do you want to give the reasons why you think it's not a good idea to keep that in?
And I'm sorry, which one were you talking about?
We're on two, and it's the very last line of number two on page two of the draft.
CEW's use is strictly limited to situations where the only alternative would have been the use of lethal force or firearms. The thinking there was is that doesn't give us anything in between. So we go from not taser use, hands-on, to lethal. And that kind of omits the whole premise for the taser.
But you also, in your email to me, you also said, what about a situation where you had, say, several people, none of which would you want to use a firearm on, but the overall situation created such a dangerous situation that the taser had to be used?
Correct.
I can see that. And so I'm completely comfortable with eliminating that line. And so if you will, just indulge me for a second and just cross that out. You'll see that we have all the bases covered later on in this policy, and we're fine without it. And if it introduces an element of confusion, I say let's just get rid of it. Three is just as it was in the prior thing. Number four, we add the word before at the very beginning of before. So it's very clear that before you can use it, you have to warn people. Okay? I think that was always the intention. And then we add the word in the second line of number four, or bystanders. So you also have to announce it in a way so bystanders would know that it's going to be used, so that they can protect themselves. That's the only change in number four. In number five, we add the word one standard 5-second cycle. Just to specify that that's what a standard cycle is, just in case the standard cycle changes to a 15-second cycle at some point in the future. We want to make it clear that we're trying to limit the use of these things. And then, as a guideline, in the second line of number five, officers may only use subsequent cycles under the same standards and limitations as the first shock. Continuous shocks are prohibited. That's all new language. Previously, there was a long list of sort of hedging and how you could, you know, reasons for the second use, etc. Got rid of all that hedging language, but with a very clear language that says, if you're going to use it a second time, it's only justifiable on the same basis that you used it the first time.
Why wouldn't it have been in the first place?
Well, it was written differently. And continuous shocks are prohibited is the new language. These are all things that if you read the literature about tasers, Tasers are, I think, seductive instruments, and they lend themselves to overuse because they're in the popular imagination, they're not necessarily seen as being lethal. But in fact, people do die from being tasered. And so the best thinking on it is that you want to introduce these sort of safety features into your policy, and that's what the attempt here is to do. Okay, so as in the continuous shocks, etc. The second paragraph in there, and here's where we sort of really get into the meat of the matter. The very last line, or the second to the last line, in the second paragraph of number 5, use the minimum number of cycles necessary to cease the danger and place the subject in custody. Focusing on danger and ceasing danger is the heart of what you'll see later on in this. And that's really what was absent from the prior policy, and that's what we want to get in here. The idea that because this is in fact a dangerous instrument, you only use it when you're facing real danger or somebody else is facing real danger. Okay, and that's the essential concept that we've added.
Ellis,
yeah.
Back to number 2. I don't really get what exactly it's saying. I mean, I liked the piece that we just took out, that it's strictly limited to situations where the only alternative would be firearms. But I don't see what I don't quite get the what the language is saying in terms of when can you use it. It's based on the action of the subjects or threat facing the officers and the totality of the circumstances surrounding the incident. It's a little blurry.
It doesn't give you the substantive standard. It sort of just tells you what are the things you should look at when you're going to apply the substantive standard that you'll see later on in the document.
You can say that about words too, and you can say the same thing about words and billy clubs and guns. You know, you should look at everything and before you decide
exactly.
to use this
that's,
thing.
So that's absolutely
kinda,
right.
So it kind of says nothing.
Well, this is from the original. This, I mean, my goal here was to not wholesale change the original thing, only change the things that needed to be changed. So if I'm not highlighting it for you, it's from the original policy, and that's where it came from. It's something that didn't need to be changed, and that's the way.
Okay.
Okay.
And your concern is the broad spectrum or broadness of the statement, and you know, it's leaving that somewhat open officer decision. This is where our training and
well, I
totality
you know,
of circumstances is widely used throughout our language.
Okay.
And I understand where you're coming from, but it's something though that kind of has to be there.
So there's some boilerplate you have to have.
Yeah, I understand.
Okay. And some of that boilerplate probably is contained in that this is not the complete use of force policy. That's 30 some pages.
Yeah.
It probably shows up elsewhere. That language probably shows up elsewhere too, based on what you're saying.
Yeah, it does. Okay, so no other changes on page 2 of this proposal.
Let me ask about 4. So maybe I'm being too simplistic here. The center of mass of the subject's back should be the primary target. So I should only get shot in the back by a taser?
Where
reasonably possible.
Yeah. Okay, and that's the language that we've historically had. And so that's that we're keeping that language. I mean, that's the idea because, I mean, you think about it, you're shooting a dart at somebody, right?
Right, yeah.
You know, better to shoot them in the back with it.
I'm thinking
less bad, fewer bad things can happen.
Then I'm running away, so.
Yeah. Okay, to press on, page 3, number 9 at the very top, first paragraph. this talks about when you have to make a report, except for readiness, testing prior to issuance. The next clause is new. Every time a CEW is pulled and aimed at a subject, that's new. And every discharge will be documented. So now we're requiring that anytime it's pulled, you got to document. My understanding is that that's actually been the policy. At least if you read the newspaper, you get the impression that that's been the policy. But it was not written down anymore, so now it is.
Correct.
Okay. It doesn't say exactly what you have to do to document that, if just pulling it. There is a lot more information on what you do to document it when you actually discharge. Okay, that's the only new material. You go down to 10, probe mode, The probe mode is where you don't shoot the darts, but you press it up against somebody. Did I get this right?
No, that's the probe mode are those darts.
Those are the darts, okay.
And then the direct
stun. Oh, the stun mode, I'm sorry, okay, gotcha. The probe mode should be the primary setting option, the drive stun mode used only as a secondary option. The word only has been inserted there. The idea is that there's some feeling that the stun mode lends itself to more abuse because you can just do it while you got somebody cornered.
So are they two different voltages, or I'm not?
I don't know the answer to that.
No,
it's either stun or kill.
Probe mode are the projectiles that shoot out,
right?
And they stay in the subject. You pull the trigger once; it's a 5-second interval. If you hold the trigger on the new model, it does continually shock, but we've already covered that.
No, continuous shock.
Continuous shock section. Every time that trigger is pulled on the taser or it's turned on, it's electronically recorded. So we can use that information to see, you know, how many times an officer used it. We can correlate that to the use of force report. In answer to your question with the drive stun mode, that's where the actual taser has to be put up against you. And the probes then are, they don't go into you, it's just a push shot, if you will.
Effects the same?
Effects the same? No, I think the probe is probably the more... Mm-hmm.
So these darts are shot into me, and then the trigger's pulled to stun me?
The trigger's pulled, darts are in the air active, and once they make the connection,
there has to be two, right?
Correct.
Yeah, because it's got to have current flowing through. I understand that, but you know, it sounded like you're saying you shoot it and they land in the person.
I have a video too if anybody wants to watch. The being shot in the back, the further the spread or range, the larger the shock, if you will. I don't want to say the terminology wrong. I'm not a taser expert, but I have been shocked both ways. And I'll take the stun over the probe any day.
Let me just go back to number page 2, number 5 for a second, because Chief, this is one of the things that you didn't want to add, I would like to add it right now, which is you wanted to add 5 seconds after the, where we're dealing with subsequent.
Number 5?
Yeah, after the subsequent shocks, subsequent five-second cycles is what you wanted to add, right?
Yeah, I just thought that defines the therapy.
So in 5, we'd add that. So pushing on, and this is the heart of the matter, on back on page 3, number 11, approved uses of this device are, cold, most of A is new, okay? And so that's really, I would say, the heart of the matter here. CEW should only be used to protect life or prevent serious injury. So that's a new thing. That is not what our policy previously said. CEWs may only be used against individuals who pose an immediate threat of serious injury or death to themselves, the officer, or others.
Why did you take out the CEW should not be used against a passive subject?
It shows up later on. I moved it. Okay. It just didn't belong there.
Okay.
So that's really, I think, the heart of our change right here is we're specifying that you really only use it to cease real danger. Okay, B and C remain as they were previously. Then you go down to 12, not approved uses. A, these are not approved uses. This is new. Solely to secure compliance with orders or instructions. And then it also says, or where the sole purpose is to facilitate taking a subject into custody. I know, Chief, you were concerned about that particular clause.
No, and I'm sorry to get back to you today with that. It was on my to-do list, yeah. And I kind of lost my train of thought with it. Just something about it, if I'm alone and I have to take someone into custody, non-compliant, that's being taken away from me as a tool, is where I'm reading it.
Well, I put the word solely in there so that it's not, solely. So that would be the only thing. We just want to take this person into custody that's our only reason for wanting to use it, can't use it. I'm comfortable getting rid of that clause, particularly, you know, if it makes you uncomfortable.
Well, it's the second clause. Anybody has any other?
I guess my question is kind of for both of you. Brian, under what circumstances are you thinking? Are you thinking of felony arrest that this person, if they were to leave, would subsequently pose a danger to someone?
That's a good example right there, especially.
I mean, they've committed a felony or are suspected of committing a felony, and if they leave there, and they could easily pose this danger, or someone who's threatened to kill someone, that if they leave there and they're in an agitated state, under what circumstances are they?
Well, that would be, you know, definitely a circumstance, especially an officer, again, alone, which we are many times now.
So, and then I guess my question for Ellis is what was your thought that when you put it in?
Yeah, I focused on the solely aspect. So in my view,
if we're only using it in these dangerous situations,
yeah,
then if we're only using it and let's see, where did that go? Oh, it's up here. Yeah, to protect life or prevent serious injury or prevent serious injury. So if there is a person who is a danger to others. Versus someone, I mean, let's look at it. Felony charges don't necessarily mean that person was a dangerous person, as we know. So under those circumstances, I mean, I know I've heard, you know, young people running away from the police getting tased because they were running, and obviously the police were trying to arrest them, but, you know, there was no danger to anybody. Including somewhere where they might be running to. You know, that's not, you weren't trying to arrest them for some dangerous situation, correct?
So are the situations that you're concerned about, can they be covered by the other?
Yeah, I was just going to say that. I think with your sole purpose, the way I'm perceiving it now, we're good.
You okay with it? Okay, then let's leave it. So the clause stays as it is.
I think the big one here, you guys, which, you know, I talked with John Grody in depth about this as well, that solely to secure compliance, it becomes a tool for many officers, definitely in high-risk areas where just having it out with the light on, you know, can help. But the problem with that I see in a community setting like this, one is the danger, and two, you've already played your hand.
Yeah.
So to speak. So that's where I'll be coming in, trying to help the officers in their discretion and decision making. And, you know, again, throwing this out there, but when we have two on, everything's a little bit easier.
Okay, so to push on Kate, you can see there B is against the passive subject. That's where that shows up. Okay, the next big change is on the next page, number 4, and we're almost done in F. The first sentence of F previously existed in the old policy, and the second sentence of F is new. The sentence is, nor should they generally be used against people suffering the effects of drugs or mental illness who are highly agitated or delirious unless significant exigent circumstances exist. And that just comes from the literature you read about when people tend to die when they're chased. And that's the circumstance you'd like to avoid. So we've added that to the list of people that you want to go out of your way to protect from tasing, if you can. But it doesn't say absolutely that you can't. The next change is in I. And this, there was a whole section on fleeing subjects that was sort of long and hard to tell what we were trying to say. Now it reads, CEW should not be used against a fleeing subject unless the subject poses an immediate threat of death or serious injury to the officer or other. It's just the same standard before. We're just saying fleeing, not fleeing, same thing. J, again, we add that the final clause to J, cause serious injury to themselves or others, to clarify that if somebody's handcuffed, the only excuse for tasing them is that. And then the next change, the final change is in 13. 13 talks about when you're going to really do a serious investigation of the use of a taser. And almost all of this is identical to what we previously had. A is the same, B is the same, C is the same, except it used to say there appears to be a substantial deviation from training or policy. I took the word substantial out, put in the word material. Substantial means a big change. Material means anything meaningful. And I think that's the standard we want here. So in other words, some real minor thing, that some little technical thing, doesn't trigger a major investigation, but anything meaningful that where you don't follow the training or policy, we're going to do a big enough. So those are the proposed changes to the policy.
Alice?
Yeah?
In 14, was that supposed to be a CEW? CEW?
Yeah, I think it is, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I just
got
a CEW
one.
Yeah. Well, so there's been, come from a lot of different groups, a request that you look at the TASER policy and proposed changes, and Ellis's group has done a great job with that, and we feel like if he, you would of course continue to run drafts with Brian and be sure that you're on the same page with the entire revisions.
Well, I mean, I have his revisions, two of them are in, one of them's not in, and if we're good, we're good. If the group is comfortable, we could go ahead and pass this and send it on to the council.
Can I make a couple comments?
Sure.
No. So going back to the question of whether you're taking the last sentence out of number two, I guess I don't understand if the statement is repeated in other places, what the rationale is for taking it out there, and you know, if the issue is clarity, emphasizing it in as many places as possible is probably a good thing. But
that was the one that Brian had.
Well, right. It's a
but if
little.
It's in number two. I mean, it's in number 11, and it's in other places.
It is, for what it's worth, it actually, I think it's stated differently. In the others, we talk about the danger to the officer or the person or others. Here, we talk about the other, we place it in a continuum of force. And I'm comfortable taking it out just because I think we have it covered otherwise.
Well, but what worries me about this is, I guess we want to be clear on what it means. So I guess I don't understand the difference. So this would be, I guess I'm also telling you, this will be my question.
Sure.
You know, as a council table. So I guess if there's something different about what's being said in number two versus, you know, 11 and elsewhere.
I mean, 11A is the standard for using deadly force, right. So it is sort of redundant, right?
Well, redundant's one issue where, you know, being clear from the beginning and being consistent throughout.
I could imagine 11A to protect life or prevent serious injury against they pose an immediate threat of serious injury or death to themselves, the officer, or others, that in those circumstances a police officer would not be thinking of pulling a gun and using deadly force. So it doesn't seem quite the same to me. Because this says you would use it only as an alternative to lethal force, while in 11, you're saying, you know, like I said, there might be circumstances where there's a threat of serious injury or death to himself. I mean, you wouldn't be shooting them if they were potentially going to hurt themselves, right? That's the difference here. This is saying you would have, and I can imagine so that's one difference, but it just sounds to me, seems to me like,
well, it sounds like both Ellis and Brian, Chief Brian, are pretty comfortable with these changes, and certainly the council will have their opportunity to dig into them again if you have a closer look at it yourself. So why don't we just come to closure about that and find out here among the group, are there any further questions or comments before we agree? I saw Bill look forward.
And I'm just, I'm hitting the same dead horse, but I like the sentence that was stricken. I like it a lot. Only because to differ with, is it Chief Ryan? Is that the term?
I'm sorry, man.
Only to differ in opinion. I like it because it really articulates the whole reason why I thought tasers were supposed to be invented in the first place. Which is, I've got a gun and I can shoot you. I can do something that won't work. I wish I had something in between. Which is kind of what I heard you saying. I want something in between. If I were going to get word nerdy on it and revise it so that it matched 11, it would be more about what the actions would result in. So if a suicidal person can be tased, and that stops them from hurting themselves, then I would want to articulate the words so that it is, so that the end result is that somebody doesn't die or come to serious injury, rather than to say lethal force. And again, that's probably splitting hairs. If you as a body feel like it's articulate through here, then you're not supposed to pull your taser unless you don't have another option, except a worse option. The gravel in the road is going to be, if that's the way it's treated. Because I do think you're right, the temptation is, I need you to comply if this thing works. And
I mean, if you think about before what happened with the four tasers were available, people who were trying to be apprehended got away sometimes, and that's what happened.
Right. And I would add.
But in this, it's saying it can be used for someone who is really a danger to other people, or to, you know, to the officers, other people, which, you know, so it does give another option to the police officer in those circumstances. But I think, you know.
Well, I would just be wary of consistency and clarity, because that's the whole point. And so, I guess I do want to make one other comment, which is with exigent circumstances in F, 12F, I would just go back to restating the standard and not leave it vague. Yeah, not leave it vague. And then the last thing is, I think it would be helpful if this is being brought to council to include the use of force report form or an example. I don't know which it is. And also, what was the other thing referred to? The response to resistance policy. It's a lot of reading, but honestly, you know, we need to see the full picture to make sure that, you know, all the pieces are in place. So that doesn't mean you need to change them, but just those should be part of all of this package.
I certainly agree with you. I can tell you that I read the whole thing and I tried to make sure that there was nothing that's not in here that's inconsistent with what's in here. But you may feel otherwise. And it's a big old policy, and frankly, it has a lot of moving parts to it, and it would take some serious time to go through it and try to make sure that it's best practices in all of its respects. I think we can do that with the taser piece of it pretty clearly, because we've done it before. Actually, I think what we will end up with here is probably not that different than what was the policy under Chief Brown.
And I'm just thinking
okay,
more
we
about want, the
if we
full
need to
disclosure.
Move forward here. Can you? Can we just say that we heard some requests for some clarity in language that you would give consideration to before we present it? Or
you feel like it's however you guys want to proceed. I mean, you know, I think our goal is
some minor.
Say yes.
Yeah.
Dave says I should say yes.
Just say yes. Say yes. So I think what we need to, because we want to move on to the mayor's court,
sure,
and make sure we have time for that.
I just want to be clear, is this coming to council?
Well, that's what we're going to now.
We'll decide that.
No, that's what we're deciding
right now. Right now, okay. We're going to talk about that.
Go.
Yeah.
Cool.
So. So the group, don't go away group, come back here.
No, it's just hot.
Are we in agreement that this has been taken seriously enough by the working group and vetted by our interim chief and gotten some feedback, adequate feedback, that it can now go forward with some of these thoughts considered as a recommendation.
I think so.
Yeah, I would agree with it. Okay. With eliminating the last line of 2 and changing CED to CEW. So,
and we're adding 5 cycles, 5 second cycles in the number 5.
Okay.
Right.
And I think it's very important that go forward since it is very relevant to the New Year's Eve.
Exactly, and we've had so many groups wanting to have attention to this. So, is that,
are
you okay with that?
I was just going to say, I think this is going to be a big discussion. Even though this recommendation is being made, and I think it's, and I'm glad it's being made, I think there's going to be a big discussion, and there's going to be also a discussion about the implementation of a change of policy like this,
sure.
And how that's, how that, once council decides, I mean, they may want to edit it and so on, and it'll be part of the process. So just to say, it's not done yet, but this, this piece of work is done.
Right.
It seems to me that a lot of this is boilerplate or rules, and what we're talking about is something philosophical that would make people feel comfortable with somebody saying, don't be an asshole.
Okay, David, can we
and
move?
And perhaps putting something philosophical in at the beginning when you work out would resolve some of the issues people have.
Okay, let's move to the mayor's court. Have you report, please? And tell us what we might be looking at.
So we agreed we're sending it to council?
Yes, you made that decision.
That's why I'm taking on.
Did everybody vote on it?
Yeah, well, we should probably take a vote on it.
Yeah, let's take a vote.
Yeah.
Okay, let's take a vote. Does everyone agree that revise Taylor? Yes.
Aye.
Anyone disagree? Moving along to the mayor's court.
All right. What you're getting is our subcommittee recommendations to council. And basically we say, you know, keep doing it, encourage the chief to send, and the police to send everybody possible to it. You can read the text. There are some specific recommendations in there that I will not read. There's also attached data from Mayor's Court as well as something from Xenia Municipal Court showing how the number of cases going to Mayor's Court has dropped drastically in the last few years. And it's increased drastically, you know, in Xenia. The last page Al put together with some findings about other mayor's courts and what they do. One thing that we continue to run into is that lots of people said a prosecutor would be really good. So we think a prosecutor would be really good.
If I could just add, the group has seen most of the other part. The new part is this findings from other area mayor's courts. That, Pat's suggestion, I contacted the clerks of some area mayor's courts, and all of them, you have a prosecutor available. Two of them have had a prosecutor for as long as they know, maybe 30 years in the mayor's court. It's always been part of the process. The interesting thing I found about the mayor's courts is the different ways in which the prosecutors were used. Moraine, the prosecutor is basically, seems like he's almost a co-equal to the mayor. They both sit behind the bench, and the prosecutor is very involved in all cases and giving suggestions to the mayor. In West Carrollton, the mayor is behind the bench, and the prosecutor is in front, but is always present, but has a much smaller role. In Carlisle, the prosecutor is not ever, is virtually never in the courtroom at all. The mayor does it all, but the prosecutor is there for the pre-trial hearings. The conclusion that I draw is that the role of the prosecutor varies very widely, and I would suggest that we would leave it up to the mayor to find the method that was most comfortable for them, but it seems like it's a very good idea for a prosecutor to be available to the mayor in some capacity. In all these courts, the prosecutor signs all the paperwork along with the mayor.
What does the prosecutor do?
We were invited to come to West Carrollton last night, but because of the council meeting and all the other, we were unable to make the meeting. I would like to go to, our intention was to observe it and see what.
And then I'm curious what it costs also.
Well, the cost is the, Laura Curls here, I talked with her because I was unable to get a figure of, from the clerks as to how much it would cost for the prosecutor. They all said it was an annual contract, not an hourly thing, but they didn't know, it's not on an hourly basis, it's a yearly contract, but they didn't know how much it was, or at least they didn't tell me what it was. I assume it's okay to say, Robert, you suggested that in a sense we could almost make it, would not increase the cost if we use the prosecutor as the clerk of the court as well, and also would be a real asset for the village to have the prosecutor available for the chief to consult with on potential felon cases and things like that. So the prosecutor availability under this contract might not really increase the cost much more. I don't want to predetermine, but June Allison, I know, is way beyond the retirement point, and she might be ready to step down. It might be a very appropriate time to do that. But I don't know, Laura, do you want to add anything?
We did talk about how we didn't want to dump somebody out of a job, just in case anybody's watching and thinking that's our goal.
Right.
Laura?
Just these small communities, you're right, they're generally on a flat contract. It supplements their salary. They are often junior prosecutors in the county. Prosecutor's office around $20,000 for a small community, $3,000 to $5,000 is my sense about it.
What do they do? Because to prosecute someone, it sounds like a negative role. I know that's not actually what they do, but I don't know.
Yeah, it's kind of an unfortunate title. And sometimes they're called something else, like assistant solicitor, and not really called prosecutor, even though that's what they do. It can vary. They can review cases as they come in for the appropriateness of the charge. They could be a control on, if you want all the cases to go to mayor's court that can go to mayor's court, then that person can make sure they end up there, you know, and how they're charged. They could help answer questions if a case should possibly maybe go to felony court and how it goes that direction. They can be a control on implementing policy and procedure.
And Laura, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't the prosecutor or the solicitor, if you will, the one who is legally allowed to make the plea deals that
your mayor in under our charter has the judicial power. The person holding the judicial power should always be an impartial. They're not there to prosecute or to put on the state's case. They're there to make a decision and in the case of the mayor's court they find the fact as well as the law and the sentencing. So the defense attorney, if there is one, is there. The person who's in charge can do their own defense. That's all going to happen. I would view that role as being a policy implementer as well. If we have treatment options or other kind of options for people as a part of the sentence or alternative, say a deferral kind of program, that prosecutor's going to implement like a pretrial deferral or a pre-court deferral program that would involve alternatives that some people have been talking about, like restorative justice and so forth.
Community service.
Yeah.
All of those kind of things.
And they'll make sure that happens and people
need to follow up.
Yeah, there's got needs to be follow-up and accountability. You know, okay, we've referred you to mediation or we've referred you to get treatment. Make sure you've done it, you know.
Could you summarize the recommendations then? The first is that to go to council, that they would recommend or put in place a policy that officers would be sending to mayor's court whatever is eligible for mayor's court.
Right. And that's the one piece that is missing out of it.
we met with Chief Ryan about and if I understood you correctly, you said for some reason you cannot require the officers to send all appropriate cases to the mayor's court. I looked through the village ordinances. I must spend a huge time. I could not find anything. I also asked Judy Kintner to find. She couldn't find anything. So I'm just confused about that. And it might be wise for the council to make whatever change is necessary so that our officers can be, if not required, strongly urged to send all cases to the mayor's court. The case at the ball drop, the one case, is March 6th going to be heard in Xenia. Now that's a perfect example of what should go to the mayor's court, in my opinion, as a misdemeanor.
I'm not trying to argue with you when I say this, but I did because I heard of your concern about that.
Okay.
And so I did talk to Chris Conard about that, and I asked him, is there a specific ordinance, a specific part of the ORC, anything like that that addresses that? And he said, no, but it has to do with the officer's discretion. And again, it goes back to the totality of the circumstances of the arrest. And so most of the ordinances that we have here in the village are mirrored by equally by sections of the ORC. You can get cited under this, under the village ordinance, or you can get cited under the ORC. And it's normally left to officer discretion based upon the totality of the circumstance. And so I understand what you're saying, and I don't know if you saw the memo that Chief Hale had put out, strongly encouraging the officers to send the cases to mayor's court. There is a memo somewhere that is out there that he did that. But my suggestion would be that you give Chris Conard a call. I'm sure that he would be happy to talk to you or email him and let him put it in writing for you and you can bring it to the group. Like I said, I've heard that you had this question and I've tried to track it down for you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so the one recommendation is that the council is asked to investigate and consider how they can require or strongly encourage officers to refer cases to mayor's court. Is that the recommendation?
Yeah.
And then the second is that the council, there you go, an actual recommendation, that a prosecutor would be some kind of contracting with the prosecutor,
mm-hmm.
hourly or annually, would be under serious consideration by the council.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the two important recommendations.
And Mayor Fobert also, as it says in here, indicated some tension between the court and some of the officers. And so we recommend that the police and the court we get together and have an opportunity to resolve that kind of a thing. And again, we talked with Chief Brian, and he was open to all of these things.
Okay, great. Ellis, did you have a comment or question?
Yeah, let me just sound a cautionary note on prosecutors. I have to admit, I was a public defender years ago. It's like cats and dogs, but there are people too. Here's the thing about prosecutors is that, in fact, they run the court. If you hear about most cases being plea bargain, that's true. Who does the plea bargaining? Prosecutors. So, in fact, in most courts, the person running the court is the prosecutor. They let the judge wear the robes and sit on the high thing because it makes him feel good. I'm not suggesting we don't want a prosecutor, but I think you need to go into it with your eyes open. And if, for instance, you had a prosecutor here that, had his or her own ideas about stuff, that's who you're going to have. And that person is not going to be elected, and they're going to be running your court for you. So you just got to be aware of that and think about, if we want a prosecutor, what do we get out of a prosecutor? Prosecutor has the ability to make deals, which is very important. There's a reluctance to send cases to court if you can't make deals first, and you're right, it does compromise the mayor. if he or she is trying to make the deals and adjudicate the thing. Prosecutor is the person to try the case. If the person wants a trial, tries it from the government side, and the person would have, you know, they can try it on their own side or get a defender. So there's plenty of reasons, but this needs some thought before we just jump right into this.
Who would the prosecutor be under?
Would the prosecutor be under?
Yeah, would the mayor be in charge of hiring the prosecutor?
I don't think he could, because then you'd have a problem.
Council would have to hire the prosecutor, and therefore, if it said prosecutor would be under contract with council, and if not performing to the expectations of council, could then be fired.
Yeah, and serve at pleasure.
Ellis, if you think we need to be thinking about this, I mean, what's the next step then? I mean, are you saying this recommendation, we should hold it till we kind of...
Well, I mean, what it says, think about it, doesn't it? You wouldn't be urging the mayor to investigate it, but you'd be urging the council.
We didn't make any specific recommendations other than we should investigate any
prosecutor. Can we please use some of our hands so we know who's... Go ahead.
All right. So I was going to... Totally agree with what Ellis was saying, and I guess my prejudice is really that prosecutorial priorities are just like and how you make plea deals just seems very political to me. So I feel like whoever holds that role should be politically accountable by making it an elected position. I personally don't see a huge problem with the mayor playing all of those roles.
Would you be willing to ask the council to consider, I mean, because really what their recommendation is to consider the need of a prosecutor?
I guess I philosophically oppose having the person setting the prosecutorial priorities and making the plea deals being a hired position, because then you've got someone who's like trying to be a professional, but you're asking them to also be like accountable to like the political whims and feelings of the community that might
sort of
shift
like
from year to year.
So like what we want the police to do.
One thing we need to step back from is to understand that some of the resistance to the use of a mayor's court. What is the resistance to the use of a mayor's court? It's because there is no prosecutor.
But I don't actually.
So this is a tactical aspect of this too, as well as practical.
Can we please reuse hands so we can take turns? Go ahead. Nia wanted to add something.
I was wondering, you said that the prosecutors in the places that you looked at, they're all equal to the mayor, more or less. Do they have to be equal to the mayor? If the concern is that you think that the mayor should be doing all these things and you guys think that there should definitely be a prosecutor, could the mayor have slightly more influence and the prosecutor
be a mediator? Good question. My interpretation, this all comes from the clerks I talked to, is that in Carlisle, the mayor is totally in charge. The prosecutor is there just to give him or her advice. In West Carrollton, they're sort of equals, but the mayor is behind the bench. And in Moraine, it seems like the prosecutor ran things. So my impression from talking to the clerks was that there's a wide latitude, but the reason that the state legislature made a serious attempt to get rid of mayor's courts a few years ago, and the clerks I talked to say that they've always had the prosecutor. They feel that if they didn't have it, that they would be their mayor's court would be in jeopardy. And all of these mayor's courts are strongly supported by the municipal court that is served that area. So. My assertion was that it could be negotiated in...
Okay, thanks, Al. Patty, do you want to speak?
I just wanted to point out to John that if your prosecutor is an if your prosecutor is an elected position, in order to unseat that person, you have to recall them. Whereas if they're a contracted position, they sort of devolve council, which is quite a bit easier to remedy.
Thank you.
Mayor Fobert wants one, too.
We have some other comments or questions.
He's been researching a lot.
I mean, given what Alice has said, and I, that you guys have done a great job, but I, you know, plea deals aren't the end all and be all either. You know, they push people into plea dealing something as a, you know, I don't know, maybe in the mayor's court it's not that big a deal. It's not like it's a felony or something like that. But I would want to investigate the idea that we cannot insist that our, and sort of in the, that, cases that could go to mayor's court, except in extreme circumstances, that isn't somehow, and I wouldn't think a police officer by themselves without talking with their chief would be making, should be making that decision. I mean, maybe that's the way to get around. I don't know what the rules are, but I, if they're, the idea that we're just doing it to get around this problem, which I heard a little bit from you, maybe that's not what you meant.
There are lots of reasons, and okay, that's one of them.
Okay.
But not right, the main one by far.
Okay.
Can we,
so I don't know.
Right. And maybe we could ask Chief Carlson to speak to this issue, this big issue of, does the individual officer have the discretion to decide? And we understand some of the reasons why they prefer the Green County Municipal Authority. But is it really their decision? I mean, that's the tradition.
It might be now.
Yes. Do you want to speak to that? There are some things that we can do in the interim, if you will, is, you know, if they understand that this is kind of the thing that I would like to see happen and we can work toward that, then that's the overall flavor. We'll start putting things through mayor's court. We are limited at this point. There are just certain laws on certain complex things. You can't do violent crimes, no domestics. Second OBIs cannot be put through. There's question about the first. So, you know, we can bring some of that back to where it was, but it's only by directive and, you know, leadership. I can't mandate it.
Chief, can I ask a question?
Let's
I don't understand that, Brian, because none of these mayor's courts could function if the vast majority of the cases weren't coming by policy of the department. And well, I can tell you from the cases I've seen that the discretion in part is not working. That these, it needs to be a policy of this village that every case that can come to mayor's court does come to mayor's court. There may be an exception where the mayor's related to the offender or some such thing, but those can be reviewed by the chief before decisions made. But I'm saying to you, there's a lot of harm happening in this community because cases are going to Xenia and they should not be going to Xenia.
I agree with you. This is an area that I'm educating myself in very quickly, but I understand this is, you know, what I've been told by some other chiefs and people that I'm getting advice from, and we have local ordinances. If we had a policy that mandated those ordinances to go into mayor's court, then I can be in that position.
That was one of our recommendations.
Patty doesn't pass ordinances.
Patty's do we have ours and fires the police chief.
I was surprised by the laws and don't get caught. So
as part of the task we took on, the review of the charter and so forth, and we talked about mayor's court, the mayor said he would. That he would like to have a prosecutor. Okay. So, and other things that happened, and we haven't had that discussion in council. But to me, if the mayor says that's what he wants, I don't know why he wouldn't present it to council so we can to work it down with it, because, you know, and you were on. And we did the charter to do it. That's what the mayor said. But we just haven't had a chance to get around to it. You folks have done it. I say, let's send it forward and let council discuss it and go up and down with it.
Thank you. So, one more.
One quick question. Is it reasonable for the recommendation to say something like it's Justice System Task Force recommendation that council seriously explore this whole notion of mayor's court and a prosecutor, and if you want our help, make further recommendations out of it.
Something like that?
Like, just sort of saying you're invited to the tea party, and if you don't like tea, we'll talk about what else to bring later. But, or, you know, if you need to know exactly what kind of tea.
So, do you want to summarize your recommendations or something?
As a number of people have said, send as many things as possible legally to the mayor's court, and change the ordinances, village ordinances, as appropriate that Chief Carlson is concerned about and that may exist to limit his power as a chief or any chief's power to do that. The mayor, the acting police chief, and the senior prosecutor and all other sources we've come across agree that having a prosecutor available would be beneficial. And a prosecutor, investigate having a prosecutor. Focus on dealing with some, healing the relationship between the mayor's court and some of the police officers.
Do you think it could be like stronger than that in the section and say?
Oh, I'm just summarizing what I wrote. I don't know what I wrote.
I was looking at that, but could you maybe say that? Strongly suggest a policy be put into effect.
I feel like that's what we're saying. I'm not sure. Did you read this?
I was looking at this one too.
Yeah. So there's not a suggestion as to how the prosecutor is going to.
No. We're saying. I mean, there are so many different ways of doing it. As Al said, we partly feel like. Most of this is a no-brainer.
Right.
We want to make the recommendation and have council have an opportunity to act as soon as possible. And looking into the specifics of the prosecutor and some of these other things, of course, is going to take time, but...
You want to get the ball rolling.
You're right. Yeah.
Okay. But we're not going to specifically say
we're not saying this is how you do it. Ellis has the opportunity, being a lawyer and being nitpicky with his writing, and he can say specific stuff, but we're not that bright.
Is this the specific proposal that you would turn in?
That's his.
I wrote that as just a.
Oh, okay. That's where I was confused. Okay.
Just saying. Did you get it?
No, I do. I was looking at this one.
This is the proposal and supporting documentation.
That's all right. I just got confused with this proposal.
We would continue to meet about the job of the prosecutor to send to council, or does council worry about that themselves?
Well, once something is agreed to by council, then I think we're into that question that I mentioned earlier. How is it implemented? What is the implementation? And who is having input into that? I don't think that's totally clear yet. I think that's up to council to decide how they're going to do that.
Okay. Yeah, sure, they come back to us and say,
so our third job is basically to say, we have researched mayor's courts to the best of our ability, and we recommend these two things. We investigate, for various reasons, the process of having a prosecutor.
Right, I understand. I was only asking to clear up the idea that he had pointed out about not wanting the mayor to be overshadowed by a prosecutor.
So let me just check that the people who are not so thrilled with the idea of a prosecutor, if you're still willing to have a recommendation going forward that it be investigated as an option.
Yeah, I mean, some of the things that were said subsequently made me feel better about that part. I was hoping for more clarity on like the cases. I mean, I know you're just saying like all the illegal. Doesn't matter. Yes, I'm happy with that.
Okay, you sure?
Yeah.
Okay. So then let's go ahead and take a vote. Do we think that the working groups, mayor's court working groups, proposals for recommendations to council can go forward?
So what's the language in relationship to the prosecutor? If you could just state that clearly. I actually care about the specific words. Mm-hmm.
The mayor, acting police chief, ZD prosecutor, and other sources all agree that having a prosecutor available would be beneficial. Many area communities have an arrangement for this, and it works well for them. We recommend this be done for our mayor's court as well.
I would not agree to that. I would agree to something that...
Considered for our mayor's court as well?
We recommend that this be investigated.
Okay. That's pretty much what people were saying.
I mean, I would think you'd actually want to make a catalog of the reasons for doing it, you know, and the reasons not to do it, weigh the pluses and minuses. For instance, the whole deal about negotiating cases. It just occurs to me that the way it probably gets done now is the officer negotiating the case.
Right. Yeah.
They don't?
Not really. The mayor, the mayor will say, ask the officer if the officer agrees to it, but generally the mayor doesn't. He makes the suggestion. There's not that separation.
But probably an alternative is for the officer to do it. I'm not saying that that's better. I'm saying that there's a continuum here, and we don't need to think plus or minus.
There is a continuum, but there's supposed to be the separation of the three. I mean, Laura's nodding her head. She's agreeing with me. The officer has his or her job. Prosecutor has his or her job, and the mayor has. And they're not supposed to cross those lines, technically.
Yeah, it seems the issue is when we have a case where someone shows up with their attorney and they're in with the mayor.
And now they're making a plea deal that could be overturned later because it wasn't made legally because there was no prosecutor on our side.
Right.
Or no solicitor. Since we don't want that prosecutor.
Okay.
Well, so with this language
investigating
change,
it, I'm fine with investigating it. Pluses and minuses. Let's look at the, you know, all of those things, and if it's a good deal.
So. But I guess my question is, shouldn't we be doing pluses and minuses? Is that what you just said?
You mean should we come up with a perfect plan for prosecutor now and say go do it this exact way?
I feel like we should not a perfect plan, but the pluses and minuses. And given that Ellis has some concerns, you know, he could help with the minuses. And I again. How it works in these small courts, what exactly they do. I know they do it in different ways, but what is our recommendation of how it's done? I think that we should actually recommend how we want to have it done here.
I think that would be useful to have a little bit more
specificity to it because
research,
you know, I don't,
and specificity, yeah, and also
if you guys are willing to work on that a little bit more, I think it'll make sure it's a.
Pretty close.
So could we pass this without the section about the prosecutor, everything else? Couldn't we come back to the
prosecutor?
Absolutely.
We're going to
do it.
We're going
to do it.
Well, definitely the one about the prosecutor.
I said if we take that out, then
and focus on the other one for now, because we won't be able to make a decision. It would go right back.
That's fine.
Yeah,
but I don't think encouraging more cases to come to the mayor's court
is
part of the.
That doesn't
happen.
Yeah, that shouldn't wait.
Okay. Well,
okay.
I was
going to
say
I feel like they're
intertwined.
Oh,
okay.
So, you know,
well, and quite frankly, Keith could put out a memo tomorrow that says.
Yep. We're working on the list of what we want to be able to go in and make sure we don't overstep that.
I guess I was going to say, I mean, the list of misdemeanors.
You would like to see what actually came.
Right. The list of misdemeanors isn't too long for you guys to like look over and be like, oh, maybe these ones we might have some concerns about those going to mayor's court because they're like super serious.
Well, so if there are 100 possible things you could charge somebody with, penalties and misdemeanors of all kinds, mm-hmm. and there were 10 of those, whatever they're called, that you could send to mayor's court. If you wanted to, would you want only 9 to be sent to mayor's court and think about the 10th one, or just say send all 10 that you can?
Well, I think the thing is, like, I know OBIs has been a concern. The first OBI, should it go to mayor's court? I don't have an opinion about it particularly, but the ones where there may be some, are there any other ones? I don't know.
He can't hear OBIs.
Let's have a point of information from Patty.
Yeah, that's exactly.
We do need to move on. Go ahead.
That's exactly what I was going. Mayor's court is not considered a court of record for those kinds of things, and that's why when you charge someone with an OBI and they go to mayor's court on the first offense, it's not a court of record. So, technically, they don't have an OBI, so then that's just the first offense.
Yeah. So they're not charged with OBI, but stupid.
Well, can we ask the working group to? Just a little more work, and there may be citizens or other people who can offer.
Why don't we take the prosecutor part that's so scary out and throw the rest of the council?
Because I'm hearing, maybe I'm wrong, but I'm hearing that people aren't quite ready.
I heard people say, how would we take it out?
I guess the question is, would council
be willing to think about it. Maybe, yeah, I guess it's okay.
Yeah,
that's a good statement.
I mean, I would say whatever's ready, we're ready to hear it.
So what's ready, what seems to be ready, what I'm hearing, is that this working group is recommending that the council actually possibly even passes an ordinance, but definitely seriously considers how they can direct all eligible misdemeanors into the mayor's court.
So to look at this paragraph, let me just, if you don't mind, let me just add a few words to it.
The prosecutor paragraph?
No, the 5th paragraph down. There are some limitations in the types of cases that could be heard in mayor's court. But for those that can be heard, we recommend that the village council instruct the village manager to direct the police to send all possible cases to mayor's court. How's that?
Yes, but you're making recommendations.
Okay.
Yeah, recommendations.
Right?
Yeah. Okay, can we take a vote on this? Do people, the committee is comfortable?
Is it a vote that negates the 6th paragraph then?
Yep, no more prosecutor.
So that and you're going to look at and you're going right. to look at that
further. Yeah, take it up and
find it. So that would be removed and then you would change the wording on
council,
the 5th paragraph?
At council to refer the village manager.
And can you include what is or is not eligible for mayor's court in your supplemental materials? Yeah. I think it's important to educate the public.
Sure. I could provide you guys with that list.
That would be great, yeah.
Thank you.
Just in the standard. I
mean, basically, no juvenile cases and no domestic violence. So those are two categories that cannot
be. Right.
There's a short list of specific statutes that are listed in the statute that creates mayor's court.
Okay.
Can't send these things.
Okay.
Okay, if we can just very quickly get quick reports from the other groups.
Do you want to vote on this first?
Oh, I thought I did. Okay, vote.
No, because I interrupted to say. Okay. We'll vote with these changes.
Sorry, I can't multitask like that. Don't interrupt me.
Vote!
Does everyone vote? Do we agree that we can
all
resist?
All in flavor?
I second the motion.
Don did not agree.
Somebody approve? Anybody
I'm going to abstain.
You abstain. Okay, but John abstains. And we invite the working group to rewrite based on our input and what that recommendation is and forward it to everyone who will not reply.
And then you're going to forward it to council too, aren't you?
Not yet.
Oh, no, so we have to
present it.
This is going through in the interim report as one of the recommendations.
Oh, I thought it was going to the next council meeting. No?
Yes.
Yes.
In the interim.
Okay, so they're not sending it directly.
Right, no working group is sending a recommendation.
Directly, it's coming through. Okay,
that's not happening.
It'll be a meeting with a capital N.
Okay. But we are accepting it tonight, so that you won't come back to a meeting again.
We'll not come back to a meeting, at least that part will not come back to a meeting.
Okay. Here comes the next thing.
Okay, so this is a quick,
I have to excuse myself. My wife is out of town and my daughter.
Sure. Thanks for being here. Thanks for being here.
I apologize for cutting out.
Okay, this is a very brief report from the police working group. Right now, the people who've met.
You know what? Can I just interrupt and say, if there's some people here that want to participate in any of the working groups, and they may cut out in the next 15 minutes before we get done, should they just leave their name on it? Write the name on it?
Put
your name and email on this.
I actually have that information.
Okay, so the group that looks at the police department in different ways, I'm just going to give a quick report on progress to this point in time. Kate has been working actually as part of HRC for more than just the tenure of this committee on the need for a social worker on the police department staff. Do you want to say anything about that, or are you just working on it right now?
I'm still in the middle of research and trying to get return calls from different police departments that utilize a social worker.
Okay,
this is like 30 in Wisconsin, I think it's Wisconsin. So okay. I've made a couple of calls, but I'm waiting for callbacks.
So, but you've done enough work to know that this is not unusual to have a social worker on, actually as a staff person on the police department or on call in some way. So that's mm-hmm. what she's working on. John, do you want to tell us what you're working on?
Yeah. So I was looking into, you know, maybe we might want to hire an intern to help with the analysis of the data, but I spoke to Wright State's Statistical Consulting Center, and they said actually for free, if I send them the research questions and the data, that they would assign one of their graduate students to do the analysis. So I'm currently hammering out the research questions. This will not be sent to the Statistical Consulting Center, and I'm sorry, this is just not, this is not a recommendation, this is just like something that I slept together like 2 minutes ago. But this is just about the speed trap on the south end of town, and basically I was like, because we can't actually say where the speeding was observed, and only where the stop occurred, it's like basically the data is too mushy to like submit it to statistical analysis. But like, you can kind of conclude that wherever they were stopped, the speeding must have occurred probably south of that. I tried to exclude the 20, and for people in the audience, there's more copies up there.
I need a speed trap.
3,000 stops. Is that what it says? 3,000?
So yeah, a total of 3,275 between Hyde Road and Herman Street. And the time frame is April 2010. Sorry, I should have put this in there. As I said, I just slept down. April 2010 to November 2016. And this accounted for, in that period of time, 60.6% of all of the speeding tickets that they wrote. This also includes written warnings. Not all of these are actual citations. And so basically I was like, does this look good to you? Do you want to see the data on the Quarry Street one also? Do you want to see the same data but with the warnings stripped out? That's like the whole question.
I mean, John's talked to me about this a little bit.
Do you want to make a recommendation about eliminating these speed traps by raising the speed limits in this area?
Yeah, I'd like to see the other data too.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things, you know, the question that he was asking me, so, you know, how should I think about this? I said, well, you know, is there a safety issue? That would be important to know. Is the speed too low? This is definitely true in some communities where you're out in the country for a mile before the speed goes up to 50, and you get lots of tickets, and that's probably how they support the community budget or whatever. So there's a safety question, and then where are the safety issues? And then because the point, if you're going to be monitoring for speeding, you want it really related to safety. And so if there is a safety issue, then, you know, that's where we want this off, you know, monitoring potential speeding. And if there's not a safety issue, then maybe there needs to be a recommendation to increase the speed at a quicker place or something like that. And I don't know if there's other rules that would apply.
What you're saying makes sense, but here's a couple things to think about. First of all, if you compare that to Quarry Street stays at 25 until you get on down past the intersection that has the second, I think that's at Stafford, and then it turns to 35. So there are a lot more intersections between them. But if you're going down Xenia, once you hit that light at Limestone, you pretty much got a clear shot except for the light at South College, and it's 35 all the way. So if you want to reduce the speed, because there are a lot of kids, I drive that every day, and there are a lot of kids that walk down there, but there's a sidewalk on the east side of the road all the way down. So, I mean, I just think it's a straight stretch that people just tend to speed up on a straight stretch that doesn't make you stop anywhere. You know, there are no stop signs at the intersections, there are just the two lights, and it's human nature to tend to go faster, and so that's where we get the complaints about people speeding, so that's where the officers go. So
So, John, what is the next step? Because we're just now reporting on activity and not moving to a recommendation necessarily. We still have some other things to do, so what would your next
step? Yeah, so like, does, basically, just like, is this like a good way to present the information? Do you want this same information? It's like time-consuming for me. So do you want to make the same information, but for Corey Street, and do you want the same information?
Oh, you said Corey Street. I just find it, I personally find it interesting because I like data.
Okay, cool. And then do you want the same information, but with the warnings stripped out also?
No, whatever you got, you know, you okay. The same thing.
This is all it would be good to separate them, maybe, or...
But yeah, I mean, before I present a recommendation, I would talk to like somebody who's
knowing about
knows
whether
that,
or not they're warnings versus tickets.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. We need to get going.
All right, cool. So just everything. You want everything. Sounds great.
And I'm continuing to look at peer communities. There are over 300 villages pretty close to us, but I'm looking trying to find some other ways of comparing them in order to look at staffing, police staffing, and also community review or advisory groups, because that has come out from a lot of different groups that we should have this. And, you know, there's a lot of debate about the pluses and minuses of a review group in particular, because that's about things that have already happened. But an advisory group, which there have been a couple of different examples out there on the internet of advisory groups that would meet of citizens, chosen by the council, who meet quarterly with the chief of police to look at any concerns or issues or hiring or whatever. So it's a slightly different thing, which I think is something worth considering, and then might be worth putting out as a recommendation. And then our for sure recommendation is to identify additional training in de-escalation and inherent bias. Now those things have come from every group. They are delivered in OPATA training, and particularly into the course that's called Policing the 21st Century, but they're very short modules, often online. So the effectiveness of the training is in question. Chief Hale previously had agreed to the crisis intervention training, which is a 40-hour training, but with the Attorney General's office asking that every officer has, every full-time officer, has 20 hours of training, then to add on CIT training and inherent bias training, we have a lot of training that we might be asking, and of course we would have to pay for ourselves, CIT training and inherent bias training. They would not be paid for, obviously, through the funds that normally pay for police training. But I think we want to go forward with that recommendation because it's widespread consensus in the community that the police need better de-escalation training with crowds and individuals. So I think we want to put that forward as a recommendation. So I'm asking this group to approve that that goes forward as a recommendation.
And I would say some of these things, I didn't get it all straight, which ones are modules and, you know, the short, and how effective the ones that there's a question. I mean, if Chief Bryan is, you know, their people are watching these things and then they have a discussion in the staff meeting or whatever, I mean, that increases the usefulness extremely. So, you know, someone having to go to some place far away to do a longer course. So I think there's ways to make the best of those.
And I believe Brian is already trying to do that. Yeah. Because it's something he's mentioned to me specifically that he wanted to start.
Wasn't there, I feel like there was something about having the training here
there,
that would help.
There's the 40-hour CIT happens here once a year in the fall. It's at Green Learning Center. And we send as many officers as we can each year, but it depends on staffing and you know, because we have to pay overtime to send somebody down there essentially. I think about half of them have gone on to the 3-hour course at this point, but I'm not definitive on that statistic.
Yeah, I don't even think that many.
I think there's two.
Yeah, Chief Hale said there's two or three. It's not half of the four.
It might even be one.
There are only eight full-timers. So
well, Sergeant Knapp had it, but I think that's the only person.
No, I know Knapp had it, Hale had it. Tommy Sexton left, but I'm pretty sure we had sent him.
Oh, yeah, Hale had it.
And then there was one other person.
Well, there are police departments with again, somewhat comparable, although maybe a little bit larger, where every officer is trained in CIT. So I think that recommendation would fit within the standard of policing, and it is a cost, and it is a staffing issue, but it's something that...
It's, I mean, we're committed to doing that,
right.
40-hour for everybody. That's not a question. It's just that we're trying to figure out how to do it.
But to put it out as a recommendation reinforces, let's do this. We said we're going to do it. We've been saying we're going to do it. Let's do it.
So your recommendation, Pat, is just for the CIT training?
No, it is not. It is that we are recommending training that is an additional to the OPATA courses, and that would be CIT training for every officer. And
de-escalation,
inherent bias training, which we would have to identify. It's not necessarily out there, or the ways in which it's out there is not evidence-based, let me say, at this point. It is out there. It's out there for kindergarten teachers, never mind police officers. It's out there for all kinds of groups. But we would recommend identifying it and taking advantage of it. So does the committee agree with those recommendations? Okay. Vote yes. Anyone opposed to this? Someone want to make the motion?
I'll make the motion.
So moved.
Second.
Okay.
It passed.
Mia?
Sorry, yeah.
We have two more short reports, please. Mia, do you want to say just bring people up to speed about the high school?
The interview? The class?
I think she's asking about the class.
Okay.
Both. We'll
all right, well, the class is doing a bunch of, having a bunch of guest speakers come in constantly to talk about what they can do and proposals they can send to council. And right now we're working on ideas on, there's a group about mending the police relationship with students and young community members. There was an idea that I had a while ago with Iyana that we talked about very briefly in one of these meetings, I'm pretty sure, where we said that we could have somebody come to the high school and talk to them and let them know what their rights are. And that hasn't been talked about since. And I don't know what the other groups are doing. I know that I'm with Iyana conducting interviews to gather more information with specifically either high school teachers or high school students.
Okay.
Most middle schoolers aren't involved, but we have people that are interested, and we're currently setting up interviews, I think, for next week.
Okay.
So, yeah.
We'll look forward to hearing more about that. And your goal is to
collect information, to add to recommendations in police reformation, and then to mend relationships with the community members and police officers. And with the other one is to let students know what their rights are in situations.
Okay. Great.
I would suggest putting the latter two together, because hearing from DECLU is going to be good information, but having the same discussion about rights and responsibilities of both sides with the police would probably be quite useful. If the police think you think something and they don't think it's the same thing, it'd be good to both be on the same page.
Yeah, I haven't done any movement on that at all. I've been mostly focusing on the interviews. That was just an idea that was thrown out that I was told recently to move forward on, because it was a big one by both my teacher and Josh.
Yeah, that was good. Absolutely.
And
then our fourth group is the group that has the somewhat nicknamed narrative group, and there maybe you could explain what the point is.
So yeah, so Mia's actually working on that with us, and Ayana are doing interviews. Doing interviews at the high school, and so I've done two interviews, and Steve's done one. I guess I wish that we'd done more, but yeah, that's basically.
Is there
what we're
an interview guide
that
you might have a chance to look at some point, just to give some feedback about?
Interview what?
A question. A guide. Well, what are you asking?
The interview template. I sent that.
Okay.
Everyone should have that. We got the interview template approved.
Yeah. That sounds familiar.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So that's the same one.
It's we're using the same thing. Okay. Yeah. Right. Yeah. And then and so similarly to bringing them in to interview people at the high school, I think we're probably going to continue down that route of bringing people in to interview people within their own.
Do you have any kind of a timeline, or are you just going to see how it goes for a while?
The problem recently has been kind of time. I haven't had time to conduct any interviews. Ayana hasn't had time to conduct any interviews, and maybe in the next week we will finally have the time to conduct interviews. Like, we have people that have reached out now and are interested.
They're really interested.
Yeah, but we haven't had solid times to do it yet.
I mean, I wonder if we should suggest to you guys maybe a month to 6 weeks, just to put a cap on time, so you kind of have a sense of, you know, and then try to get an interview or two done a week. I mean, well, I don't know, you know, with
that's
four people, if you've got two interviews done a week, you know, in 6 weeks, that would, you know, be a sizable, something that could tell us.
Yeah, time can get away.
Yeah.
So we're no longer pretending we have 2 years. I mean, no, we don't. So, yeah, that would be helpful to have a timeline. And some focus on what you're, you know, exactly what it is you hope to get out of it.
Oh, I mean, yeah, we're going to summarize the information and maybe like pull out, specific findings.
But I mean, like the recommendations about people.
Well, I mean, the idea is to get a deeper understanding of the specific. About specific things that are happening. I mean, there might be specific acute problems that we might find, and then like themes across different. Yeah, I mean, like it's just.
So no, I remember you.
Data gives you a very thin understanding of what's going on.
So I remember that you and Steve were talking about different populations, and then is this all shifted to working with young people primarily?
So the idea is not that the narrative interview group is going to find a representative sample in the community, but there's not any population. There's no one whose interactions with the police or the mayor's court that we're not interested in hearing their story. So if basically for the interviewers, if they know anyone specifically that has had interactions with police or repeated interactions with the police that they think are significant that we need to learn about to increase the justice system task force's understanding of the problem, then we should reach out to those people and not wait for them to reach out to us.
Right.
But at the same time, we're also just doing like broad advertising.
We put it on the morning announcements at the school, but nobody really listens to it. So we then contacted people. Like I talked about it in my class because I am in Mr. Lighting's government class. And after I talked about it in front of like Mr. Leidy and some of the guest speakers, then a couple of the people said, hey, that sounds cool, I have a story. And then after that, I just realized that nobody was literally listening to it at all. So like Ayana made a list, I made a list, and we're contacting people. And most of them are like, yeah, whatever.
Because I heard stories when I was in Mr. Knighty's class. Because, oh, I want to tell you something.
Exactly.
So I think the stories are there in the high school. I don't know.
And every person that I've interviewed has been like, and you should also talk to A, B, and C. Like, you talk to one person, they always know, like, really.
Well, and we've heard, even in just our couple of years at the high school, we've heard stories, and we know who the people are that have the most interactions, including the teachers. And since they know it can be anonymous, nobody is opposed to doing this interview, especially in the short.
That's great. Certainly done very, really good outreach. I've seen some things in the paper, and posters at school, and a really great job with that, for sure. So, but having a timeline seems like what would be helpful. Committing to get some, you know, find out more about what you're actually doing.
Can I get any specifics too about the dates?
Yes, that's in the template.
Okay. Yeah. I thought I had asked you that before, but I can't
remember. I just wanted to suggest that, because it's not yours here, just because the 365 committee had done that vision. I mean, I feel like we should say something about, well, is there a committee that wants to work? You know, we pretty much, you know, Gavin brought up the council, and
you know, I think they're trying to figure out sort of how to intersect with the work that we're doing. And then I know Pat brought up the question of sometimes, you know, like the PD might have their own vision. So is this the village vision for, you know, the police department? Or, I mean, so what exactly is this vision? I think that's really initially it was how council worked, you know, with public input. And now, you know, we have an active group. And I know part of Gavin's idea was we use this vision as we're thinking about hiring. And as we're thinking about maybe hiring, you know, this permanent chief process, and we use it for that. So
I just don't want to leave them hanging out
there. Does everybody know what we're talking about? Everybody understand what we're talking
about?
Yeah,
I don't even know
if everybody knows.
So maybe Jana could begin briefly.
So what I could do is I could send it to whoever's the best representative of the Justice Task Force to share with everyone. And
well,
so
I have a question before you propose the action. Gavin actually presented this to the council, so that's where it is right now. So I feel.
No, but I think council.
I mean, he shared it at public comment, so he didn't ask for any action. He just wanted to share it with the council.
Okay.
So I don't. There was not formal.
Okay.
There was no action asked by council, and actually, the suggestion I feel like that's coming directly from the council is that to go through Justice Task Force.
Awesome.
So that I think that's why.
Okay.
I think that's my understanding.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what you talk about when you talk about a vision.
There was a vision statement a year ago.
It was passed at the end of 2015.
Yeah, the council that Lori Aslan, you Brian,
yep.
Marianne worked on and brought to council, and it talks about public servants.
It's like an overarching statement about philosophy.
And it was passed. So, I mean, there's drafts on some of them.
Actually, seeing this thing on draft,
right,
the draft,
it
was
passed.
Like, was it actually done? But I think my impression was the committee, which is Janet Mueller, Gavin, and his last name,
Louise.
Gavin
Moore, Leonard,
and Louise Smith, which is a subcommittee of 365, have, you know, because I think it's come from something about the New Year's Eve event, and, you know, feeling, and the fact that we're going to be hiring a permanent chief in the next several months, and there's hiring that's happening in our PD, and just how do we, it's a fairly simple way to, if we wanted to work with them to bring in a recommendation to council, that we amend the document. I mean, that's what I think. So I'm wondering, the way I'm thinking about it is maybe a subcommittee should work with them to.
Well, I provided feedback on the first draft of the document. I have nothing. Final with the first draft of the document. And Gavin took some of my feedback. But here's my understanding. There is this document which was passed by the council. And then what was presented was modifications of that existing, I don't know what you want to call it when it's passed by the council, but to me, in my mind, they own it. I mean, I think that we felt, we all had this, I don't even know who we is anymore, but there was an understanding that 365 would take on that task of developing guidelines, vision, and they've done that. They've done a great job of that. And then they presented it to council because they're asking for a modification of the existing.
And I think we want this committee to review it first to make sure it's in line with the other work that you're doing. That's my sense of why we would come here first. But I don't know. I mean, the process is,
I think people are fine reading it and reacting to it.
I've given feedback.
Yeah, my
scientists
have already given feedback.
Yeah.
If you want, if you would like to send it to everyone and have people one more time.
I mean, well, what is the rest of the committee? I'll shoot it here.
I mean, I like the idea of somehow we process it. If we want to make some changes, we make some changes, but then we endorse it or whatever the heck and then send it on. And so then it's everybody's work and the council knows they're looking at something everybody's behind.
Okay.
I read it quickly. It seems like, you know, it's very nice. I was unable to produce a redline version of the work I did. Do you guys have a redline version that would allow me to see how this changes the original document? Do you know?
Yes, I can show you. I can send a copy of the original, the document that's currently passed by the council that Brian shared with us. I can send you the latest version we have, and if you want to see the list of recommendations that we got when we just sort of informally shared it with a handful of folks I could send you those two if that's helpful. Or just one, the latest and the oldest. I mean, the current standing and the, yeah. And the most recent edition. Yeah. That probably would be sufficient.
That'd be great.
Okay. Thank you.
And Pat, mm-hmm. I've also been wanting to, because you asked this question a couple of times and I don't think it was ever directly answered, but it's kind of related to what you were saying. Council is used to commissions sort of, you know, vetting these kinds of changes and making recommendations. So I think that is a good reason to run it through.
Yeah, I'm fine. I think I did not understand that what you just explained, that it was really just a public comment. I thought he was asking council to take the document and approve it in some way.
Well, amend it, I guess.
Amend it.
Yeah, I think that's what it is.
And something like that can
it's an amendment. It's an amendment of a document you've already passed. So
right.
I'm just a little confused about where it sits.
So they'd have to repass it.
Right.
Basically.
Yeah.
And before we, I agree with Ellis that before that goes forward, it makes sense with this body here to
just so that there are things that are disconnected
yeah, right.
or whatever.
I think it just makes sense to give some input.
So maybe
so
the thing to do is just
get us all a copy yes. and then next oh. meeting we can.
No, okay.
Give a final. Yeah. Sure.
Okay, thank you,
Ms. Sure.
That's fine. That's great.
And
anything
who should
else
send,
here?
Should I send it to you, Pat, to forward to everyone else, or is there someone else whose job that is?
Well, you can send it to me, and I'll send it to okay. me. That's fine.
So at our next meeting, then we'll be in a position to discuss this,
we'll
make
discuss
any changes
it.
We want to make to it, mm-hmm. and then report it out as work that we're also affected.
Yeah. Now let's clarify our schedules, and I'm wondering if it would be useful to have a meeting before our meeting, and that is to throw in one more meeting, or do we want to wait until the second Tuesday?
What is it that, okay, so
what do you
want to
have
do that 365?
That would be a good idea, but what do you want
to do? What is it?
Well, I think we'll have to have something of a draft of what we're going to actually put forward to the council. So if we wanted to do something, if we want to bring something to the council, let's say tentatively the first council meeting in March. How about that?
I mean, I feel comfortable letting you, Pat, if you're willing, take these recommend. You're not willing.
No, I want everyone to look at it.
Okay.
Well, to look at what?
Just the recommendations that we agreed to tonight. You want to see it in one in a form where it's
yes.
put together as an interim document.
I do.
Okay. So, rewriting them or just take and put them together in one with a cover sheet that
I
says,
mean,
here are recommendations?
Well, I'll only be rewriting to some extent the actual literal recommendation, but all of the backup stuff, no, I don't need to. That's just
I mean,
added
does it make
on.
Sense?
Because I thought we already agreed to pass those on. I'm puzzled. I'm not sure then what we voted on before.
Yeah.
We voted on the recommendation. I mean, we have recommendations on this. We have at least three recommendations going
yeah.
forward, right?
And,
mm-hmm.
and
so,
language for those, I guess
well,
we voted on the language. Are you saying we didn't?
I don't think we voted on the language.
Oh, I voted on language, okay.
Well,
we didn't even have language.
Can I take my vote?
I don't want to have a separate meeting, though.
Okay.
I mean, we've got to respect everybody's time.
Okay, how about if I send those out?
I have a
out?
Suggestion.
Good.
Send it out to everybody. And people can comment back to you
only
on their
only
on their piece
okay.
of what they did
great
to
idea.
Make sure
great
that
idea.
We got it right. That we got it right.
Great
and,
idea. And then any backup, like the final draft of the TASER policy, the final draft of anything that you're then
right.
that is just I'm not going to look at that. I'm just going to add that to the back of the recommendation.
So you won't present this Tuesday? This would be in March that you want to present
well,
to council?
Well, I think
the...
if we do it this way, let's see, what's today, Tuesday? I mean, it has to get
it's
to Judy by
Thursday.
Friday at 10.
I'm out of town.
Well, very
Tuesday
early Friday.
Okay.
So the following one?
So
the
okay.
What's the
okay.
date of the following one?
Well, I mean, we did have the TASER thing. It's not whether, I mean, we agreed it's specific language that is couple of things are coming out, one little thing is going in, we agree to that.
Yeah.
It's done.
I mean,
and I would say the same thing about our recommendation of mayor's court. So I don't know what we
I
need
mean,
to, I don't know what we need to modify.
I unless somebody wants to do it. Somebody else wants to do it, if Pat can do it.
Oh, I can do it. I mean, I will create a clean copy of the TASER policy tomorrow morning, and I can circulate it to the group. If anybody sees something wrong, they can say so, and we can be done.
I think we either have to make a decision on it and stick with it, or we have to stop talking about it. We're starting to talk about angels dancing.
I'm thinking it's because you want to try to use those six pillars to kind of plot it.
I was trying to pull us away from, but I think I'm losing the battle. Okay, here's this policy. Now there's that recommendation. Now there's this one. I really feel that, I mean, to me, that is like crazy making. But if the council feels like, oh yeah, that's fine, that's what we're used to, then we'll just do it.
So I guess with regards to Ellis's policy, it's something that there's so much interest in that even though it's only one part of the use of force policy, it is ripe into itself. Abstain on your policy, like could this year's support. With regards to the police department one, I mean, what do you think? Do you think that it's reached the fill line? Do you feel like there's more
just
to be said about?
Talking about what you've done.
Yeah, do you feel like there's more to be said about training before we send it
I've
on?
I've already said it. I have pages and pages.
All right, then great. If you
but
think
I'm
it's
not
ready.
Doing it at the next council meeting.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right.
So yeah, but the one after that?
The one after that, yeah.
Sure. Then great.
Well, it's going to generate so much conversation that I would think that council would like it to be a little bit spread out, right? Yes. I mean, because you're going to talk about tasers for like an hour.
I hear what you're saying.
You're not going to leave till like 11.
Yeah. You got to have that one in the
It's a thread.
Well, I mean, it's fine.
But it's true. I mean, the conversation's going to keep going and going and going, so.
But they can talk about it.
Right. You know what? This isn't on our tentative agenda, so I think actually going back to, I think there's nothing wrong with what Pat's saying of waiting and then trying to use the venue that you're trying to use to bring some organization to the chaos. Right. So,
because Judith, you can also report out on this.
I'm
going to
report, but we're not going to make, I don't think we're going to be making decisions out of that.
But you could mention that these
report.
Are...
These are coming,
yes,
so it needs to go on the agenda. So it's because it actually isn't on the agenda.
I think waiting, not trying to do next week. But
yes,
I think that gives everyone a chance
to
clean up.
On this discussion item.
They have to be put on. Yeah, I'm sorry. I failed my role.
What did you say, Ben?
They have to be put on the
they
agenda.
They have to be put on the agenda.
And I know our agendas are getting really full.
Yeah. I mean, let's just say for argument, we are send them on. They're going to light up and go, oh, let's put this on another
agenda. We'll put it on the next agenda. Because we have so much already. You know, we plan our agenda.
So
we got it.
March 6th.
They say March 6th, yeah.
So can't we look good by sending it to you now and then complain that you're not doing something?
And I think if we wait, we're not in a big hurry about next week. We wait, gives everyone a chance
next
to really
week,
clean up what you.
We're
going to
be hearing some information, potentially the whole report of the investigation. So there's no way we're going to have to come over this.
So our next meeting is on the 14th of March. Then.
Well, you haven't done restorative justice
okay.
yet.
Is there anything more?
Is that
okay,
yeah.
March
6th. Okay, anything else here for the good of the order? Hello, hello. Committee.
The next meeting is on the 14th.
Our next meeting then
PM.
Will be the 14th. Yeah.
Should we have should we set our agenda tentatively? So we're going to have 365. I mean, we know that, right?
14th.
Right. And then we're going to have reports for the groups.
Right. Okay, yeah.
And
the same, except the meeting.
That'll be enough.
Yeah.
So we might get out at 9. Yeah, I mean, you'll figure out some other things.
We're
going
to have to do
Well, I appreciate Pat. I just want to say, I know we're hard.
I appreciate everybody. Everyone's done really substantive work.
I'm
we have a motion to adjourn.
We're moving out of here.
To adjourn.